What has passed is prologue, as the commissioner of the Globe Theater wrote a couple of centuries ago, and the reason for which we all are here is now at hand. It's game time. It's been 2 weeks since these two teams played, and that's a long time, a devilishly long time for them to keep their concentration and their heads straight and to keep the competitive edge they had after their championship games. In addition to that, these coaches and players have been subjected every day to the same questions by radio, television, and newspaper men, many of them inane. Coach Chuck Knoll, what do you think of the shotgun offense? Roger Staubach, tell us about the Pittsburgh front four. Are you surprised your team got to the Super Bowl? Too tall, Ed Jones. How tall are you? Thankfully for all of us, that's over. And this game is now handed over for the people it was intended for, coaches, players, and fans. And so, ladies and gentlemen, here is Super Bowl X, the Pittsburgh Steelers against the Dallas Cowboys.
For both Pittsburgh and Dallas, today's Super Bowl story began with dramatic chapters in the playoff and championship games. The Steelers faced a Baltimore Colts team that surprised even its own followers by winning the AFC East. Terry Bradshaw departed from the script with a run that ended when Lloyd Mumphord upended him. A knee injury temporarily sidelined Bradshaw, adding to the suspense. But typically of this team, the defense broke the game open. Jack Ham forced Burt Jones to fumble. Linebacker Andy Russell picked it up and raced 93 yards to score. Pittsburgh 28, Baltimore 10. Meanwhile, Dallas shocked the heavily favored Minnesota Vikings. All seemed lost with time running out and Minnesota leading 14-10 when Roger Staubach hit Drew Pearson with this fourth down pass. Then with 24 seconds remaining, Staubach threw what he called a Hail Mary pass. Pearson caught it almost 50 yards away. Few more dramatic finishes have ever been written, and the controversy over the question of possible pass interference will outlive this season. And Dallas upset Minnesota 17-14. In the AFC Championship game, Oakland was shutting down Franco Harris when he took a fourth quarter handoff, swept left end, and behind John Stallworth's block on Jack Tatum, romped 25 yards to a touchdown. With Frank Lewis sidelined by an injury, Bradshaw found Stallworth with what proved to be the winning touchdown. All that remained for the Steel Curtain was to stop a final desperate Raider drive. Pittsburgh hung on and won 16-10. In the NFC Championship game, Dallas again was the underdog, this time to Los Angeles. But not for long. Staubach's pass to Golden Richards made it 14-0. Then Preston Pearson, a Steeler cast-off, wrote himself into the list of clutch performers with three touchdowns. This one, an incredible diving catch. Staubach's old-fashioned shovel pass to Pearson wrote the finish to the Rams' chances, although three Tony Frisch field goals wound up the Dallas scoring. Dallas, an incredible 37, Los Angeles 7. And now here, against the beautiful Miami skyline, Dallas and Pittsburgh will put together the final chapter today, Super Bowl number 10.
The Super Bowl today is sponsored by Ford and your local Ford dealer, who invite you to check out the values during their limited edition sale beginning tomorrow. And by the Champion Spark Plug Company, makers of the number one spark plug in the world.
The Orange Bowl is jam-packed. The temperature is 56 degrees in Miami. Good afternoon. I'm Pat Summerall. This is Tom Brookshire. And after all the hoopla, Tommy, I got to ask you if you're ready to go.
I tell you, I tossed and turned last night. It is not just another football game, Pat. You and I will try to treat it that way. It's going to have the humorous moments, but now it's up to the players. I think Whitaker said it all before the game.
That's where it should be. Let's briefly go over what might be the injury report, and it's not very long.
Well, it's not very long, but it's important for Pittsburgh. If Mean Joe Green, and I'm not going to call him Mean another time, if Joe Green can't play and force some action up the middle, and he has a bad shoulder and a bad groin muscle, they're not going to be the same defensive club. They are the best secondary in football. I'm speaking of Pittsburgh now. The best three linebackers in football, but Joe Green means a lot to them. And I don't know. Without him, I think they might have to gamble themselves on defense.
Their offensive unit, of course, still has a question in their mind about the condition of Lynn Swann. I talked with him yesterday at the final Steeler workout, and he frankly said he wasn't feeling too good. I talked to his father a few minutes ago, and he says that Lynn is still not feeling too well. We'll have to wait and see. As far as Dallas is concerned, what's the situation?
Dallas is extremely healthy. Maybe Harvey Martin might have a slight thing, but there's an old saying in football, the bubbles come up. There won't be any. We're talking about going in the tank, and for a Super Bowl, there is no tank. The injured are going to have to play, and there's going to be walking wounded that are going to do a heck of a job.
I got a feeling that we're going to see one heck of a football game. As you know, Pittsburgh is a very steady, a very solid team that depends on ball control. Dallas, they're not afraid to take a chance.
They do everything from either the spread, the shotgun, or man in motion. They're going to probe in the first period. They're not a big scoring team early, and Pittsburgh hasn't allowed a touchdown all year early, so stick around a while.
Look what I got here, my friend. This is what they use to toss the coin. Dallas won the coin toss, by the way, they will receive, worth $4,000.
How did Norm Schachter ever give this to you, the official?
Well, I'm not going to let you hold it too long. Maybe we can split this thing up. We repeat that Dallas won the toss, they will receive. Super Bowl number 10 is about ready.
Independence Square, Philadelphia, and there go the Larsons to discover a part of America's history.
The Continental Congress adopted the Declaration of Independence.
Liberty
right here.
Bell is inscribed, proclaim liberty throughout.
Later
all
they discover.
Oh no, the lights.
The Sears Die Hard, with extra power to start your car when most batteries won't. It's making history. Sold only at Sears.
Right now is a special time to buy at your local Ford dealers. It's the 1976 limited edition sale with sportier looking Mustang 2s that give $137 of additional retail value at no extra charge. A specially equipped limited edition Elite, $200 less than Elite's standard base sticker price. A striking looking and specially priced Torino you've never been able to buy before. And the Explorer specials. Ford suggests you act now. Quantities are limited.
Buy now or lease at your Ford dealer limited edition sale.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, let's meet the starting defensive unit for the Pittsburgh Steelers. First of all, the front four. Defensive left end, standing 6'6", weighing 245, seven-year veteran, number 68, L.C. Greenwood. The rest of the front four, number 75, Joe Green, 6'4", 275. The right tackle is Ernie Holmes, number 63, the right end, Dwight White. And now the three Pittsburgh linebackers. At one outside linebacker spot, number 59, Jack Ham. Jack Lambert in the middle. Andy Russell on the right outside linebacker spot. And now the defensive secondary. Left cornerback, number 24, J.T. Thomas. The right cornerback, number 47, Mel Blunt. The left safety, number 23, is Mike Wagner. The right safety, number 27, Glenn Edwards. And now cut Chuck Noll and the rest of the Pittsburgh Steelers. Introducing now the starting offensive unit for the Dallas Cowboys. At left tackle, number 73, Ralph Neely. The offensive line for the Dallas Cowboys, number 73, Ralph Neely. The left guard, number 66, Burton Wallace. At center, number 62, John Fitzgerald. The right guard, number 61, is Blaine Nye. And the right tackle, number 70, Ray Beal Wright. Next, the receivers. At tight end, number 84, is Gene Fugit. Wide receiver, number 83, Golden Richards. And finally, number 88, Drew Pearson. The backfield for the Dallas Cowboys. Number 12, Roger Staubach. Number 26, Preston Pearson. And number 44, Robert Newhouse. Coach Tom Landry and the rest of the Dallas Cowboys. We'll be ready for the national anthem and the kickoff of Super Bowl X in just a moment.
I love baking cookies. My specialty, little gingerbread men. But my wife and me also like vacations. We planned on going this summer, but then United comes up with this 30% discount now. So now's the time to go. Because with this fare, I can save more now than in the summer.
Save 30% on round-trip coach with United's Freedom Fare.
30% off. That's a lot of gingerbread men.
United Airlines.
You're having fun and building up.
Hey, look who's here. Shoot.
You're thinking about the beer that lots of people reach for first.
How about a beer?
Reach for hands, the sky blue water beer. It's running good.
Man, that's good.
Reach for a hands, it's running good. Running good.
Orange Bowl in Miami, as the captains for both teams are meeting in the center of the field. Roger Staubach shaking hands with Andy Russell. Sam Davis also out there. Leroy Jordan. The officials in today's game, and they got here just like the teams did, by doing the best job. The referee is Norm Schachter. Umpire is Joe Pennell. Headlinesman is Leo Miles. Line judge Jack Fetty. Back judge Stan Javi. And field judge Bill O'Brien. 97 years of NFL experience among the officiating crew.
And they got through the toss without somebody making contact.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, to honor America, we proudly present our national anthem as sung by Mr. Tom Sullivan and the cast of Up With People.
What so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming,
whose broad stripes and bright stars
through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming.
And the rocket's red flare,
the
young man who just sang the national anthem, Tom Sullivan, is blind. But I don't think Tom Brookshire I have ever heard it done any better.
That is so strong, and perhaps it makes me think about people like Vince Lombardi and the late Burt Bell, and that's about the last time we're probably going to get a chance to have a soft remembrance thought for a while, because both teams are out there. The kickoff man is Roy Girello. Again, remembering that the fourth period, the Steelers will have the wind to its back, you can say that.
Right now, Dallas has won the toss. Roy, kick it off. There is a very strong wind. 15 miles an hour, pretty steady, but with gust up to 25. Deep for Dallas, number 26, Preston Pearson, and number 21, Doug Dennison. They're standing about the five-yard line, and 10 years of Super Bowls are about to begin. Some great memories in these past 10 years. And here is Roy Girello now to start Super Bowl number 10. Kick by Girella. Taken by Pearson, the ex-dealer at the three. Reverse comes to Henderson, the linebacker. They've got it set up. He's got 9.5 speed. He can really go. Tom Henderson back to the 44-yard line of Pittsburgh. Stopped by Girella, the last man who had a chance. 52-yard return by Henderson.
He said the Cowboys would gamble. Now watch Pearson. He played with two other teams in other Super Bowls. Here's the reverse. Randy White peels back. Donovan peels back. There you can see a couple of the blocks. And you're right. The last man right now has to come up. Hughes has a pretty good shot at getting him. Good tackle by Girella.
Girella took him down low. He was the last man. That's the play Dallas used during the regular season to score a touchdown. Down Cowboys at the Steeler 44. They break one early. Staubach has Fugit in motion. And Roger, a fake on the first play. Fumble! Dallas got it back. John Fitzgerald, the offensive center, made the recovery and picked it up and advanced it. L.C. Greenwood into the secondary in a hurry.
Here's the first play, as we said. The Cowboys are not a great first quarter team, but L.C. Greenwood was there so quickly. He took the inside, and Fitzgerald, the fellow that started the play, darn near ended it.
Like about second and 15 now for Dallas. That play lost five. Ball back close to midfield, just in Steeler territory now. Staubach gets to Newhouse. Maybe two, maybe three. Ernie Holmes, Joe Green, the rest of the Steeler defense on the bottom of the pile. Andy Russell, too.
Now, defensively, Joe Green is in there. L.C. Greenwood, who made that first tackle, is at left end. Ernie Holmes, who's a penetrator. In fact, the entire Pittsburgh defense is basic but extremely physical. That time, they tried to finesse Joe Green a little bit. And notice number 75. He'll really crowd Fitzgerald. He sets up any kind of inside action right on the center's shoulder pad, really.
Could bother him here, too, Tommy, in the shotgun. Fitzgerald with a good snap this time. Holmes got loose, pass down the middle, incomplete, intended for Preston Pearson. Overthrown by Roger Staubach, who is fighting a pretty good wind. Ernie Holmes was right in his face when he let go.
And Burton Lawless, the only rookie starting this game for either team, does have a tough job in trying to block number 63.
So punting situation comes up for Dallas, fourth and about 12, and Mitch Hupps is in the game, number 9. I asked him twice this week, how do you pronounce his last name? Once he told me Hoops, once he told me Hups.
I'll tell you, he's passed, he's run, he's done everything. Let's got a high snap, got it out of there.
Got a good kick, headed in the corner in the direction of Glenn Edwards, and Edwards has it outside to about the 18-yard line before the Dallas special teams herd him out of bounds. This telecast is presented by authority of the National Football League. It's intended for the private use of our audience. Any rebroadcast or other use of this telecast without the express written consent of the National Football League is prohibited. So Terry Bradshaw, the last man into the Steeler offensive huddle, checks it in. Steeler ball at their own 17-yard line.
What did you think about Bradshaw's condition, the taped knee, the right knee? I watched him try to pick up just the football off the ground. He is not not the same Bradshaw that can really burn you with the run.
Talked to him yesterday about that very thing. He just can't run as well as he did before he took that shot from Lloyd Mumford. First down, Steelers. Running backs, Blyer and Franco Harris. Franco gets the first call. Outside goes Harris for good yardage. He got about seven. Whip Harris got him out of bounds.
And Rocky Blyer got the real good block on Leroy Jordan. Now, Pittsburgh is about an 80% run team to the right. They're working against the defensive line you see right here. That time on the first play, they also went against the grain. And that's where Franco, though, has broken some big plays in the past. They're the linebackers. And Leroy was handled by Rocky Blyer, who can really block. The secondary's come on for Dallas, playing much better than they did earlier in the year.
Lynn Swan splits out to the right for the Steelers. He will start. Gave Harris an 8-yard pickup on that first down carry, so it's second and two for the Steelers. And that is Blyer banging into the Dallas secondary, right up the middle. Stopped again by Cliff Harris with help from Waters. Watch it again.
Let's take a look at the trap locking inside right now. You're going to see Cobb come down from the outside and really take Jethro Pugh out. And bust block Rocky Blyer at a pretty good hole. Let's watch it now. Watch the left guard. He goes straight on. Here comes the outside tackle coming down on the inside trap. Jethro never saw him. Number 75 really went over.
First down, Steelers. The ball outside there, 30 now. Franco Harris straight ahead. And again, he leans for about four. Steelers, it would appear so far, have running in mind.
Well, they always have running in mind. Again, they're very basic. Blyer's supposed to be the blocker. But we might recall behind this offensive line, which is not super on the individual basis, but boy, they played together very well, is that Blyer did have 163 yards at one time this year against the Green Bay Packers, I believe.
Second and five.
Come on, big shot, go!
Harris again. Ooh. Almost first down yardage, stopped by Harvey Martin from the opposite side of the field. With help from Dave Edwards.
I think Chuck Knoll's trying to tell the Cowboys something through Bradshaw. He is saying, we are a strong football team. There's Tom Landry. We don't have to tell him. But I'll tell you, Franco Harris is the best big running back in football.
Maybe, too, Tommy, the best big game running back in football, too.
In playoffs, he's incredible. Like
he has really been tough. Extra tight end into the game now for the Steelers, Randy Grossman. In the backfield by Mark Washington, the quarterback, who came up well as Harris tried to bring it to the outside. They did not get the first down, and Harris is slow getting up.
Now, this is what Franco likes to do. He's trying to actually probably get off the tackle. The Cowboys seal it off beautifully. You can see that now he goes outside. Again, the cornerback was released on the short yardage and came up and made a tackle on the 230-pounder. Washington has come on very fast, I think, in the last part of the season.
Veteran Bobby Walden, number 39, in punt formation for the Steelers. Golden Richards back by himself for the Cowboys. They've got a pocket. They got him. Dallas turns it over again. Dallas second big break of the game as they swarm on Roy Girella. Warren Capone, the first man there, number 59.
He's another one of those free agents, right, that the Cowboys seem to acquire to do the job. Here it is. Fumble snap by the veteran kicker, Bobby Walden. Dynamite.
Down on the Pittsburgh Steelers 29-yard line.
Steelers didn't have a turnover last year, winning the Super Bowl in the entire game.
Roger Staubach sets him up as Pearson moves to his back. And he fakes to Pearson. Staubach going for the bundle. Got Drew Pearson across the middle. He might get in. Touchdown, Drew Pearson. The Cowboys take the lead. 29-yard touchdown pass from Roger Staubach to Drew Pearson.
And Patrick, absolutely no pressure on Roger at all. He faked the in run. He made Drew Pearson shift back. Now watch the fake and see where Lambert, number 58, goes. Lambert drops back. He's still undecided. I'll tell you, Drew Pearson coming under. He's not only a gutsy receiver, he's dynamite when you have to catch it. Look at this.
Tony Frisch in the game now to try to make it 7-0 Dallas. And he does. is stop and think back over the history of the Super Bowls. And all nine times before this one, the team that scored the first touchdown in the game went on to win it. Dallas leads 7-0. And Blunt gets outside the 30. Good return. What looked like it might be a disaster. Let's look back at the Dallas touchdown again.
All right, Pat, watch Lambert now, and watch the fake by Roger Staubach. You don't get a chance to see quarterbacks fake very well. This is a good one, because Lambert stops for just a moment and checks, number 58, and does a drop back and look for the under receiver coming, which Pearson's already cleared. Good play.
And a Dallas touchdown. Right now it's Pittsburgh ball. First and 10 for Bradshaw. He gets to Franco Harris. And Franco cuts back inside for a big pickup of 8 yards.
Remember, Terry Bradshaw calls most of his own plays. That time, he caught Jethro Pugh making a premature lunge across. And Dallas sort of plays a controlled defense. They don't penetrate like Pittsburgh does. But they caught Jethro sort of getting back and blew him right out of there.
Pittsburgh quickly out of the huddle. Bradshaw didn't take much time. 9 minutes, 45 seconds left first period. Dallas 7, Pittsburgh nothing. Second and 2. Rocky Fire caught from behind by Harvey Martin. Harvey Martin and Tutal Jones, the Dallas defensive ends, are very, very quick.
Boy, Jethro Pugh that time went under the center Mansfield, making contact, and then Harvey came over the top side. Now look at that defense. Again, they do not play like the Pittsburgh front four. They're a little bit perhaps faster. They like to stunt. There's Jethro Pugh. He came up here so early, he was about 18 years old when he signed his first contract. He wasn't even driving there.
He's still playing like he's about 24 years old. Third and very short yardage. He was an extra tight end in the game, and Randy Grossman. And Mullins, the regular tackle, comes down the line. Steelers get the first down, and Harris almost broke it. Stopped by Cliff Harris.
Now, before somebody worries about number 72 being a flanker, the Steelers have to notify the officials, and then they notify Dallas that number 72 is a legal receiver on the offensive side. And he is the offensive guard, and they use him to come back through and try to clear out on short yardage.
A maneuver he just executed right there. First down, Pittsburgh. Steelers yet to throw a pass so far. They have the lead. Backs the ball at the 43-yard line. Rocky Meyer gets the call and gets the two. Chased down from behind by Charlie Waters first. Got some help from inside.
Meyer's quite a story just in himself, isn't he? Back from Vietnam, and he did have quite a few injuries from shrapnel, grenades, and what have you, and he's really fit in here.
There's Tom Landry trying to figure out how the Steelers are able to run so well against his defense. 5 yard pickup by Meyer. Ian Harris, the two deep backs, Swan and Stallworth, the right receiver.
Bradshaw has really yet to put it up. At
9 rushes, no pass. The direction of Lynn Swan, caught by Swan. Legal catch.
And one of the great catches, Pat. Watch Bradshaw. He doesn't use much play pass action. Now watch this move by Swan to the outside. Washington has the one chug. But I'll tell you, the young man from SC is fleet. There's the jump. Boy, he gets them both down. A beautiful reception. The ball well thrown.
Washington is right with him.
Watch this drop back now. Terry has the deep drop back. Good pass protection. Hey, that is on the money.
Steelers line up in the I formation on first and 10. Rocky Meyer straight ahead, gets inside the 15, down close to the 10. Meyer to the left. Bradshaw calling all the plays, has thrown just one pass. That big completion to Lynn Swan.
Tell you, Clack did a heck of a job on Harvey Martin that time. He actually logged him in. When your offensive guard can go outside the defensive end and take him down, you're doing a pretty good job up front.
That Steeler offensive line is really firing off the ball. Second and 5. Lambert to the outside. And he bangs to about the 7-yard line before the Dallas defensive unit can converge on him. It takes two most of the time. The concern you can see on the face of Tom Landry.
We've had our first altercation on the field. Rocky Blyer is working against the linebacker. And Blyer can block, right? Franco really slips right off his hip, and then Dede and Blyer exchange whatever players do.
Third and one now for the Steelers. The ball marked right at the 7-yard line. Dallas 7, Pittsburgh nothing. But the Steelers are at the door.
And Mullins is in on a eligible receiver spot as a flanker, the guard. There he goes.
Bradshaw. Touchdown, Grossman. They fake the same play they used on short yardage before, and Bradshaw found tight end Randy Grossman for touchdown. Watch it.
All right, Pat, let's watch our offensive guard go right behind Bradshaw. Watch this. 72 goes in. The fake is there. Everybody's fooled. And there's a free agent from Temple University that is the best tight end receiver they've got, but he comes in really on short yardage more than any time else.
Grossman 6'1", 215, now with Bobby Walden holding. Roy Girella will try to tie. It got over. It was deflected, but it's good. Indication from Norm Schechter, the referee.
All right, let's watch the inside fake. Let's see if number 72 Mullins does his job. He just sets up. I think Edwards might have fallen down. Looked like the linebacker took a false step.
Miami. Roy Girella set to kick off for the Pittsburgh Steelers, who just tied it at 7-7. Another high kick, this time in the direction of Preston Pearson. At the 11, he's got it. Got some room, too. Pearson out to the 35-yard line before he's hit out of bounds.
All right, Pat, how are we going to second-guess ourselves on this? Both teams are not big scoring teams in the first period. They've taken advantage in the first period. Both have touchdowns, and this Super Bowl may be one of the highest-scoring ones ever.
Sure, you know, there's been a lot of criticism about the fact that the Super Bowl games in the past have been dull. Such is not the case in number 10. Dallas has a big contingent of fans here. So do the Steelers. First and 10 for the Cowboys. Callback. Gets to Newhouse to the left. Some room for Newhouse. Newhouse with about a 7-yard pickup. Stopped by Ernie Holmes to the inside. Help from Mel Blunt.
I keep in mind, too, that the Cowboys rush extremely well to their left side. They run right off Ralph Neely, who had, I think, the best year he probably ever had. And they ran at Dwight White, a guy that might be the best all-around defensive lineman the Steelers have in all categories. Newhouse is only 5'10", but I think he's proven. And he can almost get 1,000 yards in this league in Chicago, right?
He almost did. 5 minutes, 12 seconds left first period, 7-7. Duke Pearson in motion. Callback. Gives to Duck Dennison. This time he's got a Dallas first down. Good blocking by the offensive right side. J.T. Thomas on the tackle.
I tell you, Mean Joe Green is not very active in there right now. When you've got a pinched nerve in your neck, your shoulder, your hands are so very important. That time they just sort of took Joe Green inside, and there was a lot of room between the defensive end and the defensive tackle.
Rocky Blyer, Jerry Mullins talking with the offensive coordinator for the Steelers. First down, Dallas, the ball at the 48-yard line. Their 48-yard line. By Fugit. Close to first down yardage to tight end Gene Fugit, who was punished by Glenn Edwards.
Watch Neely now working against White. Now at the far side, Rayfield Wright and Nyland are doing a good job too. The first shot, Neely keeps there, takes that one shot by Dwight White across the helmet, and Fugit already has the catch. This might be the only man in the league from Amherst. Maybe ever. Fugit turned out to be a heck of a receiver inside now.
Swift of the Miami Dolphins is also for them.
I knew you'd catch me.
I didn't mean to. First time with any Super Bowl so far that both teams have scored the first quarter. Quick draw to Newhouse. Good room. A lot of room for Newhouse. Down inside the 30 to the 27-yard line of Pittsburgh. J.T. Thomas again on the tackle.
That time they take the seam and let Joe Green have it. Now you're watching. Watch Ernie Holmes come across. He's the penetrator. Now they've already cut off. Neely goes to work on Lambert. Now watch Nye and Fitzgerald take Joe Green and bury him. There's the trap by Nye on Holmes. Boy, Newhouse had a lot of running room.
That block by Neely coming across from his left tackle spot really sprung him. If you can get at Lambert, they think you can handle it. First down, Cowboys. The ball at the 27-yard line of Pittsburgh. Pearson in motion. This way again. Works again. Quick handoff.
And again, it looks like Dallas, they're getting pretty good splits. And they're allowing the inside tackles to make their quick move and then just turning them aside. That time, Ernie Holmes and Joe Green again were caught on the wrong side of the line of scrimmage.
Chuck Dole looking on right now with much concern, obviously, about what's going on with his defense. Terry Bradshaw alongside. Roger Staubach, the opposing number 12. Richards and Pearson now split to the left on the same side of the field. Buck Dennison flies for about 3 or 4 yards, close to a first down.
A sort of an option run. They just handed it to him and said, you're on your own.
That's the young man who seems to get better and better every week. The more he carries the ball, the stronger he gets. Here come the substitutions for Dallas. Preston Pearson and Billy Joe Dupree.
In the past, the Dallas Cowboys have thrown a lot on short yardage situations. But with a 7-all tie and about 5 or 6 inches, I would imagine they'll get the first.
50 left in the first period. 7-7 between the Steelers and the Cowboys. Newhouse, who has that uncanny knack to fall forward, stopped by Ernie Holmes, but he's close. Little altercation going on downfield right now between Drew Pearson and J.T. Thomas, the cornerback and a wide receiver. They were out of your picture, but the officials quickly got it stopped.
Well, if there's ever been a harder hitting secondary in football, in pro football, and the fellows back there for Chuck Noll, I've never seen them. They are by far the most belligerent, the most combative, and I really appreciate the way they do it.
I bet you do.
You better believe it.
Cliff Harris could play for them, I think.
He'd be perfect.
Newhouse, any part of the ball, remember.
Boy, I'll tell you, that is close.
Like about the length of a knuckle. One of Joe Green's knuckles. Dupree and Dennison, who had checked out, are back in now. Landry and Jim Myers. Myers shading his eyes. He's been with Tom for a long time.
There's not any doubt what you're going to do. Looks like the teams have decided that 7 points is certainly better than three. If you can perhaps get 3 inches.
Tom Landry has decided that he wants Roger Staubach to go for it. If you know, Landry calls all the play. Brings it back. And Dallas got it. First down, Cowboys. It is Doug Dennison who got the clutch yardage. Jack Lambert on the stop.
Pretty obvious what Dennison did. He wasn't thinking about end zone, which once in a while against short yardage you can pop through and get there. But actually it was his late lunge that got him the yardage needed. He wasn't looking for much.
Now less than a minute left in the first period. Dallas first down at the 15. Steelers shift on defense as Dallas shifts on offense. Inside handoff to Pearson, and he popped. Jack Lambert, the middle linebacker, was not fooled that time.
They were trying to bring the trap down from the outside on him. Now you're looking at the right defensive end against Neely.
Jack Lambert laid the wood.
Huguette was trying to come in and trap a middle linebacker right in the hole, and Lambert at 6'5 is certainly the new Dick Butkus, I would imagine. He is quite a brawler.
10. No gain on that last play. This might be the last one of the first period. Staubach to Newhouse. Not much there either. Again, it's Jack Lambert on the bottom of the tackle.
I asked Art Rooney before the game if Jack Lambert, his second-year madman from Kent State, is married yet. Art said he may never get married. This guy can walk through your front door.
Big, tall Jack Lambert, the middle linebacker who was fooled a couple of times early in the game, has not been fooled on the last two plays. It's 7-7 into the first period. 1,000 plus. Watch watch the Dallas Cowboys break the huddle and come up with the 11th play in this drive.
Passing situation.
Third and nine for Roger Staubach. He's in the shotgun. Ralph Neely is too early. Neely jumped back a little bit too soon.
Neely moved. The thing to keep in mind, there's the illegal procedure call. The keep in mind is that Staubach is an eligible receiver because he is not under there as a T-formation quarterback. And from what we've seen early, looks to me like Landry and company may try almost anything.
They're going to have to pull out an ace right here because it's third and 14.
73! Offense!
Norm Schechter, the referee. You heard his call, the violation against Ralph Neely. First quarter statistical picture, pretty easy and pretty even.
Looks like a seven all tie, doesn't
it? So far it does. Just the opening seconds of the second period, and Roger goes back deep again in the shotgun formation. In motion is Charles Young. Now he comes back to block. Call back with protection. Had a chance. Edwards.
Oh.
Had a chance to really do something for Pittsburgh. Couldn't hang on.
That time, Pittsburgh did a stunt inside, a twist between Joe Green and Ernie Holmes. And Holmes almost got there in time. Now watch the two inside men to the right of your screen twist. Watch Big 63 come along. And Charlie Young tried to block him. Here's the throw. Edwards never had a better chance.
Pass was intended for Gene Fugit. Edwards looked like the intended receiver. Now Tony Frisch on the 26-yard line. Tough win today, remember. Frisch got it high enough. Let's see. His reaction would tell you that it's going to be good. Dallas 10, Pittsburgh 7. A good-looking drive by Dallas until they got in trouble down close to the Pittsburgh goal line. Nevertheless, Frisch hits, and they lead 10-7. By a 36-yard field goal by the man who's about to kick off right now. Number 15 is Tony Frisch. This one off the side of the foot in the direction of Mel Blunt. Blunt has it at the 14. Hit down outside the 30, about the 33-yard line by backup linebacker Bob Brunig, number 53.
Let's keep in mind the number 82 for the Steelers is a fellow named John Stallworth. He doesn't start, and nobody can figure out why. He made the big block a week ago or 2 weeks ago against Oakland that sprung Franco Harris. He's got about 4.6 speed, but he gets it right now. He runs a good pass pattern, and number 82 is in the game. Bradshaw may go to work topside.
Right now, Mel Renfro comes out in front of Stallworth. Bradshaw goes back to pass. Rushed by too tall Jones, and Bradshaw is really popped as he let it go. Ed Jones got away from Gordon Gravel and almost took Bradshaw's arm and head off.
To show how the Cowboys are gambling, and Bradshaw now senses that more than ever, they also blitz the outside linebacker. Edwards came from the weak side, and he or Tuttle both cleared. But I guess Bradshaw saw Tuttle before he saw number 52.
I'd imagine he's 6'9 and 260. Hard to even see around him. Bradshaw just took a look over in that direction. Second and 10, Pittsburgh. Harris and Blyer, the running backs. Blyer gets the call and gets good yardage again. Tom Henderson, the linebacker who had just come in the game replacing Dave Edwards, made the tackle.
Mike Webster, number 52, is in there. He and Mansfield alternate quarters. He made a good block and really sealed off Jethro Pugh. Boy, both teams are really able to make emphatic plays. Those are good holes when you see them there.
Some cool sunshine in Florida today. The 56-degree temperature is good for football.
That's got to be LC.
Third and four.
Close it.
Some conversation from the sideline, perhaps you heard. Bradshaw goes back to pass. Harvey Martin had a shot at it. Leroy Jordan had a shot. Bradshaw got the first down.
All right, the first time we've seen Terry Bradshaw run, a lot of people would be surprised at his speed. He's about a 4.5 40 man. He does have that taped up leg, but look at him put it away. If you think number 12 isn't some kind of a quarterback, you got another thing coming. People worry about his IQ and all that. Don't worry about Terry Bradshaw. He still wants to challenge tacklers, but this time he got out wisely.
First first down. Steelers, the ball at the 45-yard line in their own territory. Dallas on defense on the left, Pittsburgh on the right. Back to Franco Harris. Harris, as he does so well, picks the hole and gets first down yardage. Charlie Waters was back in the backfield early, but Harris, with those quick feet, cut back inside and got a Steeler first down.
Reaction was super by the Dallas team on defense. Watch Franco Harris turn. Real good lateral pursuit by the controlling defense. Watch Edwards and everybody play it. And boy, he cuts back inside. And maybe that takes more out of a defense than anything. Watch Leroy Jordan, the problem. Right away, they know what it is. But everybody overruns it, and the Steelers make sure.
Franco Harris now with 8 carries for 42 yards. Steelers at the Dallas 45. Bradshaw outside, stalwart. Nothing in there. Harvey Martin really put the clamp.
Good play by Mel Renfro, number 20. We've been watching him for fear that he might not be able to run on those bad feet. This is just a pitch to John Stalwart. Now watch to the right of your screen. I don't have to describe that, do I?
I can feel it. Harvey Martin. Too Tall Jones, you know about. Harvey Martin's nickname is Too Mean.
Too often and too mean.
Yeah. Often too mean. Bradshaw back to pass. Stalwart grabbed it, dropped it.
That's a completed pass.
It's a completed pass and a grab.
They're going to call this a completion. There's going to be an argument by Cliff Harris and everybody, which is understandable. But that's another one of the great receptions we've ever seen. Watch this, number 82. Now watch the pattern he makes. He's looking for the seam. He drives Renfro off. Now watch how he elevates quickly from both feet. Now he's got it. Now it's kicked out. Good defense, better offense.
It is ruled a completed pass. Pittsburgh got it back, 3rd and 2. You'd have to guess Franco Harris here. Franco got it. Harvey Martin with a big hit.
I mean, Harvey Martin is mad. Number 79 is an incredible athlete. Watch the right of your screen now. Too Tall is being handled. Martin just stomps right into it.
It is 4th down, Steelers. A yard at least. And the indication would seem to be that they are going for it, as Jerry Mullins probably lined up in an eligible receiver position. He's number 72. That's what they've done before. Grossman, the backup tight end, also in. 4 out of 5 for Terry Bradshaw so far. At the 41-yard line, Bradshaw is going for the bundle. Harris can't hang on. Franco Harris had first down and daylight. He can't hold it. Cliff Harris.
Cliff Harris really measured Franco, and if the safety man doesn't make that move and get inside, Franco Harris might have had a touchdown. Watch the inside fake, and it's a good one by Bradshaw. Everybody's there, and the back just did a straight right out of the backfield. Man, that's super contact. The Harris twins.
Franco and Cliff in a violent collision. Dallas 10, Pittsburgh 7. Superbowl number 10. Statistic on the Cowboy defense. They just stopped the Steelers on 4th and 1.
The only stat there that's really worthwhile was what they did to the Rams only 2 weeks ago, right?
Billy Joe Dupree, number 89, is the Cowboy tight end right now. 1st and 10, the ball at the Dallas 36. Newhouse, maybe 2. He might have fought for an extra one.
If you're a football fan, and I guess you almost have to be able to watch this, but the linebackers, the outside linebackers, and Mr. Lambert in the middle, that's got to be the best troika maybe in this game in a long time. Jack Ham is incredible. Andy Russell has done everything but pump the balls up for Art Rooney, and Lambert in the middle is savage.
Something you pointed out before, that perhaps Joe Green was not his normal self, might be by Chuck Noll right now, because Steve Furness is a defensive tackle for Pittsburgh. Starback
throws.
Outside, caught. Duck Dennison. Not quite a first down.
Well, I'll tell you. Roger Staubach, though, is so cool. Now, watch how he doesn't desert the pass blocking and run with it. There had to be a tendency here because Furness, the man that you mentioned, number 64, gets good pressure on the double-team block. But Roger doesn't bolt and run and throws it off the wrong leg and gets the completion.
And Jack Ham took Doug Dennison down short of a first down. It's third and one.
Here's Jack Ham. A little reaction. About 218 of the best linebacker.
To see. From Penn State, one of many to come out of there. Third and one. Callback, back to pass, throws outside, overthrows Newhouse. Jack Lambert, the middle linebacker, out there rolling on top of Newhouse. Dallas will have to kick.
Pittsburgh defense didn't get them all the way here to roll over and let some team blow them out of here in the first half.
Clint Edwards and Dave Brown go back. Chuck Dole in the insert. Mitch Hupps will punt for Dallas. Averaged just over 39 yards during the regular season. Number nine is unpredictable. Drive to be handled perhaps by Brown. It is. Dallas special teams down in a hurry. They are super. Randy White led the charge.
Well, you know who handles the special teams for Dallas is Mike Ditka. And I guess if you didn't do a good job on Sunday, that you'd have to fight Ditka on Monday.
And every other day in the rest of the week. Part of the crowd who's had a marvelous time here in Miami. We saw him somewhere else.
Almost anywhere else.
He can go wherever he wants in that outfit. 9:05 left before the half. Pittsburgh ball, the ball on their own 23-yard line. Bradshaw, Flyer, and Harris, the backfield. Flyer gets the call. This time, Dallas seals the middle pretty well. But again, Charlie Waters, the safety man, had to come up and help on the tackle.
Pittsburgh feels so confident of their rushing game, they just don't throw the ball on first down very much. And I guess the cliche, you got to get something on first down, is important. But Bradshaw just does not like to throw on first down.
There's Harvey Martin. Defensive end for Dallas. He goes inside. Fine play by D.D. Lewis, the linebacker who got back and got a hand on the ball.
Let's take a look. The Cowboys try a twist. Martin is going inside. This is not a very good defensive stunt. Nobody really made penetration quickly, and if you stunt and don't quite make it, you're vulnerable. That time Harvey Martin was. Good play by Didi, and Del Renfro looked like he might have been whipped on that deep sideline to me.
That's right. If Lewis hadn't been back there deep, Stallworth was open. Third down for Pittsburgh now.
There's the three-man front.
Wide receivers for Pittsburgh. Harris still standing up in the backfield. Now he's ready to get it. Bradshaw back. And Bradshaw is down. First sack of the game. Harvey Martin again involved.
Now the three-man front, Pat, makes the middle linebacker key that most quarterbacks watch completely unavailable. You got three men down. You got Randy White running around. And suddenly a guy like Terry Bradshaw or any other quarterback doesn't have that great key in the middle linebacker. Now he's confused. Harvey Martin helps a little bit more.
Randy White also got a piece of Bradshaw. He checks in on the sideline. Golden Richards back by himself for Dallas. And Bobby Walden to punt for the Steelers. High kick. Richards got his hand up. Fair catch. Dallas ball close to midfield. They'll take over at their own 48 after just a 32-yard punt by Bobby Walden. So the Cowboys get it with 8 minutes, 4 seconds left in period number two. They lead 10-7. Super Bowl number 10. Dallas 10, Pittsburgh 7.
You want some trivia?
Lay it on me.
You know, Roger Staubach has never played against Pittsburgh, either preseason or regular season.
Is that right?
Maybe that's the reason he's so healthy.
All right. That should certainly contribute to it.
Right down here.
Right now, his Cowboys have a first down. He goes back to pass. Way deep to Staubach. Over the middle. Caught by Preston Pearson. Quite a story of Preston Pearson, the fellow who just caught that pass, too, Tommy.
Roger Staubach really stands in there. We're going to talk about Preston Pearson, Pat. Pretty good call on first down. The thing I like about Roger, particularly today, is he is not looking to run. You can see the action as Joe Green and Holmes try to move in. He really stands his ground. He's not looking to perhaps get injured. And again, the Steelers drop back so quickly,
Mike,
sort of throwing under that Steeler defense.
Second and about a half yard as we're back live now. Staubach almost fumbled. Good. Staubach, I believe, got back down on the ball himself, but we'll have to wait and see.
I'll tell you one thing, he never had it. Watch the snap. Fitzgerald snap. Roger is, let's see if he pulls away. He just never quite had it, and he put it on Dennison's hip.
Notice that time that Joe Green, who's back in the game now, was lined up right in front of John Fitzgerald, the center. That would be a little disconcerting.
It would be if that was Joe Green as we normally know it. With the pulled groin and the muscle, I just have a feeling that we're not seeing the same great all-pro defensive tackle.
All that confusion ended up in about a yard's loss for the Cowboys. Now it's third and about two. Make this to Newhouse. Outside. First down, Dallas.
Here's a guy that just tore the Rams up a week ago. Preston Pearson was a basketball player out of Illinois. Now watch the catch. Maybe only a basketball player could make this one. But he seems to do it week after week for the Cowboys or the Steelers or even Baltimore. Here's Fitzgerald working on Joe Green.
Look down, Mike.
Backs back up to get the pattern. I think Joe Green is not making a lot of penetration.
Cowboys down to the Steelers 36-yard line now with a first down. Gets the call and gets hit in a hurry by Mike Wagner, the strong safety man. Dallas cheerleaders, as well as a great contingent of Dallas fans, also on hand. Gain up the top of your picture, of course, the Goodyear blimp.
Now, Fugit may not come back. The tight end left earlier. He's got a pulled hamstring. A hamstring is not the easy thing to come back in the second half for, that's for sure.
That Goodyear blimp just barely would fit inside this Orange Bowl. In fact, it would almost reach from one end zone to the other. It doesn't look that big. But we get some great pictures from up there. Second and eight, Staubach back. Across the field, Lieutenant for Pearson, but Jack Lambert was right with him. He had the right key that time.
It was a forward pass, but I'll tell you, Dallas is a good screening team. By that, I mean they get a lot out of their screens. Jack Lambert read it like a book. Roger knows he was lucky. So does Tom Landry, I would imagine.
Landry talking now to Doug Dennison as he sends in the plays. He shuttles, for the most part, Pearson and Dennison. Tom Landry. He says, if I call the plays, then I know what to look for before it happens. That's why we do it.
And Staubach does not complain about that either. Let's take a look now and try to keep our eye on Drew Pearson. If you get a double on him, which you should get on the outside, they might do something else. But number 88 is the guy to go to.
He comes wide to the right side, covered by J.T. Thomas. Charles Young in the game for Dallas. Staubach looks like he might take off. Got away from one. Got away twice. How much time can you have? Caught by Young. He gets back inside. Dallas first down. Down to the 21-yard line is Young. What a job by Stallman.
Another thing, the offensive lineman did not go across the line of scrimmage, which usually happens when this kind of a scramble takes place. Here it is, from what they call the spread or the shotgun. 5 yards back, and Roger can see it all. Remember, five receivers can get downfield. Now he's in trouble. And now he isn't. Roger, you are something else. What a riverboat gambler he is. And Charlie Young has the presence of mind to keep it going upfield and stop the clock.
A fine-looking dance by Staubach. Dallas, first down, Steeler 20. Outside his new house, hit almost as soon as he got the ball by Andy Russell. He read that one well.
Russell's been reading him well for like 13 years. He told me the toughest thing he ever had in this league was being player representative for about 4 or 5 years. It's hard to get the dues money out of him, you know?
especially after the season's over. Just over 5 minutes left before halftime at the Orange Bowl in Miami. Temperature again in the high 50s. Perfect day to play. Golden inches. Split wide to the left, Drew Pearson to the right. Drawback. Back to throw again. Pressure is on. Steelers got it. L.C. Greenwood as they stunt it up front.
The Steelers stunned it, and L.C. took the inside and got away with it. Let's see how it happens. To the right of your screen now, watch number 68. He comes inside, a quick twist. Now, that was a good defensive flex split twist type maneuver, and very quickly he's upon him, and, ooh, Roger, get down, get down.
12-yard loss as Blaine Nye, number 61, just took a glance to the outside, and by the time he looked back, L.C. was gone.
Again, if you've got great individual people in the secondary that can go mano-a-mano, you can afford to do that. Good defensive stunt.
12-yard loss back to the 35-yard line. Richards right, Pearson left, shotgun formation. This time the protection works. For a while, I thought he might get out of the game, but the Steelers finally shut it down.
It was Dwight White, the big right defensive end, that finally got a part of a tearaway jersey. It almost tore Roger in half on the thing. Roger had a lot of time, but that secondary for Pittsburgh is very good, and they bang you. Watch Roger now. He has the time. There's nobody open. Look at this shirt job.
And now number 9 with his back to you, the Dallas punter, Mitch Cups. Trying for the coffin corner in the direction of Brown. Ball goes out of bounds at the 5. Between the 5-yard line and the 6-yard line, a 39-yard punt by Mitch Cups, and a good job. Roger Staubach now perhaps a little bit confused by that Steelers secondary and defense looking on. He's been sacked 3 times for a loss of 27 yards.
It's like when the Steelers are really backed up as they were then they will go ahead and gamble on defense. And, you know, they usually don't have to gamble on defense. I don't think Terry Bradshaw would throw it on first down there, do you?
I don't think so. 3 minutes and 47 seconds left before halftime. Bradshaw with the same 2 running backs, Meyer and Harris. Meyer breaks one tackle. Outside, out of bounds by Edwards.
Okay. Turned it up.
And Harris to help. Maybe he got 2. But behind the quarterback, watch that Dallas defense converge.
Remember, they do not penetrate a lot, but they slide along the line of scrimmage and try to control more or less an area. This time, actually, they missed a tackle. Meyer picked up some yardage anyway. They will slide along, so you're not going to be able to trap them as effectively as you might against Pittsburgh.
Meyer, 7 carries for 30 yards. 2 yards pickup on that play. 2nd and 8. Harris the call this time, Franco. And again, that pursuit catches up. Dave Edwards. Watch him.
Let's watch number 52. Closes from behind. Also, Waters came up and forced the play from the outside. Franco had nowhere to go.
As the clock still runs down close to halftime, 3 minutes and 10 seconds remaining while the Steelers break the huddle. Neither team has used a timeout as yet. Third down, Steelers. Draw back. The blitz is on for Dallas. The Steelers pick it up. Lynn Swan out there. Caught it! What a catch by Lynn Swan. On the rebound. Mark Washington with him again, but again he caught it.
All right, this was against the 3-man rush, and Pat, you called it. The Cowboys came with everybody. Watch this. Here comes the start. Good pass blocking. People are going over and over. The long throw. Look at the tip now by Lynn Swan. And the catch on the other side. He's made 2 incredible catches. We're not at halftime yet.
The lot of doubt about whether or not he'd be able to play, too, after that concussion he suffered against Oakland. Right now, the Steelers are out of the hole in Dallas territory. Ball of the Cowboy, 37. First down for Bradshaw. Looks like an automatic. Intended, I believe, for Stallworth. But it looked like Swan had a chance to catch it, too.
I tell you, Swan was open running the post behind that under pattern. That time, the Pittsburgh offensive line gave Terry Bradshaw all the time he needed. They are excellent at using their hands right to the legal limit of the law. They throw them out and push the defensive lineman away. And then just as the official gets ready to drop the flag, they bring them back in and get legal again. They're excellent.
2-minute warning now as Bradshaw heads to the sideline to talk things over with Chuck Noll. The Cowboys still lead 10-7. The Orange Bowl is packed.
And then they pull those hands back in. The defense, meanwhile, is straightened up, and that was simply underthrown.
Second and 10, the ball at the Dallas 37-yard line. Tom Brookshire and Pat Summerall with Super Bowl 10. The 30-yard line, perhaps inside the Dallas 30. Stopped by D.D. Lewis.
That time they ran a false trap and fooled Jethro Pugh. They pull this way, and Jethro takes it and comes inside. They don't even have to block number 75, and Blyer runs what might look like an old crossbuck to a lot of football fans.
Clock still running, a minute 34, 33 now left before halftime. Cowboys up by 3. They're still not within the range of Roy Girella as yet. Third and 2, Pittsburgh. Anko Harris. Pittsburgh burns a timeout with a minute 10 left before the half. And Bradshaw comes to the sideline.
He went right to Mullen's side there. The right guard and, of course, Gravel at right tackle. He did a great job. Again, I think Bradshaw and Chuck Noll might decide they do have open receivers right now. And I don't think they probably thought they were going to have people playing that well in the aerial game.
Especially when Dallas allowed only just a little bit over 43% of the passes to be completed against them during the regular season. I imagine they'll check them out right now. Conversation with Chuck Noll still. Assistant coach who coached in the Senior Bowl game once told me that even if Bradshaw couldn't even throw the ball, he would recommend that his team make him a first draft choice. That's how good an athlete he is.
The great thing was that he took punishment, which, you know, you don't want to draft a guy because he can take it, but a quarterback these days, if you can't, if you're not big enough, and he's about 216, you can't take a shot from somebody 270, you know, play tennis for a living or maybe golf or something.
Right now, Bradshaw is back in the Steeler huddle. Dallas leads at 10-7, but Pittsburgh has the ball in Dallas territory in pretty good shape now.
And you better play the corners on defense. Stallworth and Glenn Swan can both get to the play.
On first down, Bradshaw drops. Got away from two. He's coming back to the outside again. Bradshaw still has time. And found his tight end, Larry Brown. He fumbled. It's still Pittsburgh ball. The official rule it dead. The Cowboys don't believe it.
And Pittsburgh is going to hurry up now. Let's see if we can show you what happened. And they call Staubach the scrambler. But here's what we're talking about with strength. Bradshaw is strong. He's agile. He's tough, and he hits the man that was a hero last year.
Rocky Blyer takes the handoff from Bradshaw. He wants him to hurry again. He just looked back and checked the clock. Now it shows 33 seconds. And now they take timeout number 2. They have one left.
Now, Roy Girella, the Canadian, is 15 for 15 from about the 37-yard line in. And I'm sure they don't want a tie score, but Bradshaw and Chuck Noll, they might sort of take it, don't you think?
I think so, except I was watching him kick yesterday in the workout. And at this closed-in The wind seems to just come over the top of the stands and push the ball down. Nothing is going to be easy going this way.
You kickers all are amateur climatologists, right? You always go out and check clouds and all that.
Well, you have to be. You don't want to try from too far out.
How about that poor guy, Terry Hanratty, right? He still holds most of the Notre Dame passing records. He's only taken the snap three times. He's standing right in front of the coach there. Three times this year as the backup quarterback. Bradshaw won't let anybody else in there.
Pretty good idea. Chuck Noll with his last-minute instructions to Terry is Tom Landry. With his team leading 10-7, walks on the other side of the field. Third down and about three is the situation for the Steelers now as Leroy Jordan comes back to the defensive huddle for Dallas. Swan and Stallworth, the wide receiver. Stallworth left, Swan right. Almost picked off by Mel Renfro after it was deflected by D.D. Lewis.
There's the corner we were talking about. Everybody saw it 2 weeks ago when Stallworth beat the Raiders in that corner. Pretty well played. And, you know, D.D. Lewis has gotten as much depth, and number 50 is playing as well as we've seen him, and he's played pretty handsomely in the past. Here's Girella, huh?
Girella's got his spot at the 26, so it'll be a 36-yard field goal attempt, the same distance that Tony Frisch hit from. Girella shading his eyes right now. Timeout for Dallas. Let's make him think about it a little while.
All right. Now, Pat, kickers are not worried about the timeout particularly, but you do like to kick off the artificial surface. Not you. We were before the stuff came like this, but actually these kickers from the side saddle, they do like the rug, don't they?
I think perhaps because of an off field, a muddy field, or a wet field doesn't allow them the traction when they come in from the side with their left foot. They slide and they have trouble making contact. Might say a word about this artificial turf. It's been criticized a lot.
It should have been.
But they've done a heck of a job getting it ready for this week. There were some rips and tears. This is the last game that's going to be played on it. They're going to replace it. But right now it's not bad. These are ideal weather conditions. If it's too hot, it's slick. If it's wet, it's slick. Right now, it's just about perfect.
Don't forget, at halftime, of course, we've got... I always mention Phyllis George first, and I don't know why I do that, but she and Brent Musburger and, of course, Irv Cross will sort of analyze this thing, and I think halftime might almost be as much fun as these first two quarters.
I know why you did. Such a gentleman.
Right.
It is... not good. No good. Morella pulled it left.
A line drive, Pat. He didn't get it up much at all, did he? You describe, sir.
He whipped it just went outside the left upright. I think it might have hit the left upright and glanced into the stands behind.
I wonder if maybe they saw, watch the number 70s in front of you. Take it back a little further if we can. Oh, too late.
Comes up with the ball now with two timeouts remaining, 22 seconds left before halftime. Staubach has decided that we'll go into the dressing room like we are. He gets to Newhouse. He's stopped by Dwight White. Down to 10 seconds left before the half. It looks like the Cowboys will go inside leading 10-7. They will not run another play. They'll head for the locker room. The end of the first half of Super Bowl number 10 with a score. The Dallas Cowboys 10 and the Pittsburgh Steelers 7.
George Paparo's 74 Chevrolet gets better mileage now than it got before. The only difference, a fresh set of champions. Ralph Mazzillo's 72 AMC Matador gets better mileage now than it got before. The only difference, a fresh set of champions. No matter what you drive, a fresh set of champions spark plugs alone can help mileage and performance. Which side is your car on? Get better mileage. Fill her up with champions.
Most people's biggest investment is their home. But their second biggest investment could be in here, their car. So protect it with Quaker State Motor Oil. Regular changes with Quaker State can help reduce costly engine repairs. Made from high-quality Pennsylvania-grade crude oil, you can find Quaker State in more places than ever. HD Super Blend or Deluxe. Your second biggest investment, your car, is well worth the investment in Quaker State.
This touchdown came against Buffalo in last year's playoffs while we were on our way to the Super Bowl championship. This is the hat that I wore that day, and this is the hat that I wore a few weeks later. Members of the NFL USO Tour wear it each year on their goodwill trip to hospitals and other installations in the Far East. Each year, USO Tours bring great moments to a lot of great guys halfway around the world, and you help make it possible when you support the United Way. Thanks to you, it works for all of us, the United Way.
The preceding announcement was brought to you as a public service on behalf of the National Football League. And now for the halftime activities in Super Bowl X, let's go to Britt Musburger, Phyllis George, and Irv Cross.
Thank you very much, Pat Summerall. And Phyllis and Irv, never again will they say a dull Super Bowl. Those two catches by Lynn Swann alone were more exciting in four quarters of some Super Bowls that I've watched, Irv.
Well, no question about it. You know, whether the score at 10-7, of course, it indicated the excitement in this game. And you have to really be happy about it. But you have two great quarterbacks here, of course. And with Bradshaw and Staubach, they have the ability to get plays on their own and make big plays. We've seen that this half.
And although their Cowboys are going into the locker room ahead by three, their confidence, I'm sure, is up. But they've got a tough second half ahead of them, don't they?
Well, you know, one play sometimes can turn a ball game around and set a mood. And I think that reversed when Tommy Henderson took the handoff from Pearson on that opening kickoff. Everybody kind of opened up and relaxed a little bit and let it all hang out, as Tom Brookshire might say.
Well, there wasn't any question about that, but I think it sort of set the tempo for the game, too, because both clubs started doing things that were uncharacteristic of either Dallas or Pittsburgh. They started to take gambles early in the game, and I think we're going to see that again in the second half.
It is such a pleasure, Phyllis, listening to Pat Summerall, because there he was, a kicker. I would have second-guessed Chuck Knoll for not kicking a field goal earlier, and he talked about the wind, and sure enough, Jarella misses down there.
That's right. Well, Pat, of course, knows what, you know, wind problems can be for kickers, and at the close end of the stadium, you saw that ball take off, and all of a sudden it drifted off to the left, and the wind does swirl down there, and of course, Chuck Knoll's decision not to go for the field goal was right.
That hand of Mike Pearl that came up here said, Phyllis George, take us up with people at this super halftime show.
I would love to. We have hundreds and hundreds of young kids from 40 states and 17 foreign countries presenting for you some of the greatest sounds in American history. They performed in 38 countries over the years. The inception was in 1965. It's an educational program from the University of Arizona. I think we're going to enjoy it. And I really feel very privileged that we get a chance to hear these great kids perform.
Thank you.
celebrating her 200th birthday, which isn't very old compared to the ancient civilizations of Asia, Africa, and Europe. Some folks say we've come a long way. Others say we've got a long way to go, and you know, probably both are right. Years, a country made up of practically every race and nationality under the sun. They all had their different kinds of music. Then came new songs and new dances, telling the story as it unfolded from the Virginia reel to rock, and from the Charleston to the hustle.
Regular comedy.
couple of centuries from where it all began.
If you watch and listen to young people like that, and you get a lot of confidence in the next 200 years, folks. And Phyllis, I guess we use music about as much as any network ever has around sports this year. We wrapped an awful lot of football coverage with music.
We certainly did. You know, Brent, sometimes these pieces were funny, and sometimes they were touching mixes of song and football. But one which stirred a particularly warm response called back memories from the great Green Bay Packer dynasty in contrast to the team and the coach and the problems they had this year. Well, for obvious reasons, we at Super Bowl X think this is a particularly good occasion for all of us to see it again.
kind. Smiles were gave to one another for the way we were.
The Super Bowl today will continue after this word from your local station. Poppy, who holds three jobs to support two sons and still makes you laugh, premieres Tuesday right after Good Times on CBS. Now let's travel around the league with American Express.
First half highlights, Irv Cross, a turnover right away. Bobby Walden, I thought the snap was pretty good to him.
The snap was good, but Walden had difficulty handling the snap from center. You can take a look at it as soon as it comes up here. Walden, who's 37 years old and a 12-year veteran, has been probably the most experienced guy on that Pittsburgh Steeler team. And Pittsburgh just seemed to, you know, have all kinds of problems starting the ball game. Here it is right here. Now watch the snap here. Off to his right slightly. A good snap. Couldn't hold on to it. The Cowboys stop him there, setting up their first score.
And here they come right now. Staubach is going to hit Drew Pearson, who made that miracle catch to eliminate the Vikings. And Pearson sprints into the end zone. Now Terry Bradshaw on that first pass to Lynn Swann.
This is a miraculous catch. Now watch this. Swann is well covered here. Now he goes up. He's only 6 feet tall, but has tremendous jumping ability. He makes a great catch.
Randy Grossman was wide open here.
We're talking about teams gambling a little bit. This is a little unusual for the Steelers. Grossman goes in for a scoring, a good play action play.
Well, Robert Newhouse ran very well on this sequence here for the Cowboys.
You know, we have that good line blocking up front there. Newhouse is a quick, powerful back and picks up good yardage there.
Tony Fritsch kicks this field goal right here. That put Dallas up, of course, by three. But we got to show you that last catch by Lynn Swann. Didn't lead to a score at all by the Pittsburgh Steelers. What a play this is.
A fantastic catch. Bradshaw going back here, just letting the ball go as far as he can. Now Swann's well covered. Now watch this. The ball's tapped, keeps his eye on it, and comes down with it for a miraculous catch.
And so, at the end of the first half, it's 10-7. We'll be right back to talk a little bit about what the Pittsburgh Steelers might have to do in the second half to get back in this ball game in just a moment.
What do the Steelers have to do to bring back-to-back Super Bowls to Pittsburgh?
My guess is simply this. Lynn Swann's had an incredible day catching the ball. I think they'll put the ball in the air the second half, so watch as he bombs away from the Steelers.
What are we going to look for from Dallas, quickly?
That's Tom Landry.
All right.
A great second half of football coming up. Then we'll have a locker room show. We'll review all the highlights of the ball game, and then out to the Phoenix Open Golf. A lot of action coming up right here on CBS.
Around the League has been sponsored by the American Express Card. Don't leave home without it.
Set for the second half of Super Bowl number 10. I'm Pat Summerall with Tom Brookshire. Right now, the Dallas Cowboys lead it 10-7 as both teams have returned from their halftime instructions, and Tony Frisch is set to kick it off for the Cowboys. In the direction of Mike Collier, Dave Brown, and Mel Blunt. So far, they've kicked away from Collier. Here comes Frisch. High kick in the direction of Blunt again. He takes it at the 8. Cowboys down quickly, and a good hit by the special teams. Howard and Henderson, the first men down. Tom Henderson with the big hit.
Pat, let's see in the second half if Bradshaw and the Steeler coaching staff don't believe they can throw the football. They've had some people open. You can see Bradshaw's completed 6. So has Roger Staubach. 102 yards against only 47. They've rushed for 92, and Franco Harris is about on schedule, too, with 40-some-odd yards, but Bradshaw had some open receivers, and Dallas better cover him up.
It is first down, Steelers. The ball at the Steeler 26. Harris gets the call and first down. Larry Cole rolls back inside, but some help from Ed Jones to stop him after about 3.
Jones on the tackle.
Second. Opening moments of period number 3 in Super Bowl 10. First half. Outstanding football.
One penalty, an illegal procedure, and not a turnover, only the bad snap handled by Walden. That's quite a half.
Second down, 7 to go for Pittsburgh. Bradshaw fakes, goes back outside to Franco Harris. No place to go. Harvey Martin from the opposite side of the field after he is cut off by Tutal Jones.
Let's take a look at Harvey Martin, and you'll see number 72 come in, too. It's just a toss. After the inside fake, watch Martin. This is sort of search and destroy. Tutal has already arrived, and Franco Harris is looking up about 7 inches. There's Tutal.
Leroy Jordan said before the game, if we can keep Franco Harris from 100 yards, we can win. So far, as Tom Brookshire just pointed out, he's just over 40. And now the Steelers have 3rd and 12. That goes Bradshaw. Incomplete pass, hit by Cliff Harris.
Cliff Harris did not make first team all-pro at safety, and I'll tell you, he ought to sue. Number 43 plays the ball and the receiver better than anybody. Bradshaw getting good protection. Look at Collin working against Martin. Watch number 43 now, stay with it. Broke up a little bit, but he also broke up the play.
Bobby Walden back to kick. For the Pittsburgh Steelers, Golden Richards in single safety. The Cowboys try to block it. Richards, fair catch signal, juggled a little bit, but held on. So the Cowboys get their first offensive chance of the second half as Roger Staubach brings out his offensive unit.
You know how close they got to blocking that punt, and I watched the Steelers work against that, ganging up in the middle by the Cowboys all yesterday afternoon. They almost got that one.
Very close. A crowd at the Orange Bowl, 80,187. And a lot of those standing in the aisles. Super Bowl record set in Los Angeles in Super Bowl number 7, 90,182. But no more could get here today. First down, Dallas. Ball at their own 42. Pitch back to Preston Pearson. He dipped inside, cut outside. Mel Blunt played it as well as you can.
Little misdirection out of the I formation by Landry. And it fooled absolutely nobody. And again, that Pittsburgh secondary They play the line of scrimmage against the run as well as anybody. Here it is. The misdirection should work. Nye's out in front. Preston Pearson, the former Steeler, has a little bit of a problem. Like he's got a heck of a lot of a problem. Look at this. Old friends.
Problem in the person of Mel Blunt and Jack Lambert, the middle linebacker who came out to help. It's second and 10. Straight ahead pop for Doug Dennison.
The middle linebacker, we've mentioned him often, and we should, Jack Lambert. I have never known anybody to come in this league and start every game as a rookie and do the job he did a year ago. And he's just improved. He's not old enough to call age, but man, he is some kind of a middle linebacker.
And he doesn't look like what you have in mind the pattern of a middle linebacker should be. He's 6'5 and about 218 pounds. Most of it in the heart.
Rodgers got to put the ball up somewhere.
Joe Dupree, the tight end, is split wide left, shotgun formation. Staubach to the outside, intended for Richards, picked off by J.T. Thomas. First interception so far, Thomas to the 30, to the 25, inside the 25 is Thomas, the cornerback. Watch that again.
Here's another one of those great number one draft choices. You're going to see Thomas come out of nowhere. Again, he's the underman in the zone, plays it beautifully, and now this guy can run with it. Another thing the Steelers do extremely well. And boy, they go back on offense. Here's Golden and company. The first turnover might be the largest of this game.
They put the ball down at the 25-yard line of Dallas and Terry Bradshaw. With Rocky Blyer and Franco Harris, the running backs take it over in good shape. First down, touch back inside for about two or three. Middle linebacker Leroy Jordan came out to make the tackle.
Well, that time, Harvey Martin was completely fooled and ran inside looking for something. And Blyer had a very easy time of handling them. There wasn't a lot of yardage on the play, but perhaps a little confusion on the Dallas defense right now.
Steeler offensive line is the one that started the game. Cold, Black, Mansfield, Mullins, and Gravel. One split right. Harris again cuts back against the grain, his favorite move. Charlie Waters on the tackle.
Again, Franco likes to run left, but this time they start him off right to the weak side of the formation. And Pat, you described it. You're behind the Dallas defense. Watch this. Starts out like he's going dead right. Watch him cut back inside of Jethro Pugh. 230-pounder. Joe Paterno keeps trying to get him to go back to Penn State.
That would be against the law. 11 minutes left, third period. Dallas leads by three, but Pittsburgh is threatening. Harris again. Got inside the 15, got enough for a first down before Mel Renfro hung on to make the tackle.
You know what else Franco Harris does except be the MVP of last year's Super Bowl? He's involved in more charities and more young organizations and all around Pittsburgh than any person I've ever known. His time is never that valuable, and somehow he just sort of rolls in the Super Bowls and he doesn't get tight. And some of the other Steelers were tight, but not Franco, right?
Not at all. Not Franco. He was checking out what kind of shoes to use yesterday, and that was his main concern. I'll tell you how hard the wind is blowing. Bradshaw makes a reverse, gets away from two. Pugh finally chases him down with Ed Jones.
There was a busted play where Terry Bradshaw just couldn't get the handoff made.
He wisely kept it.
Watch the operation now. It starts out that way. Starts to do it and keeps it to that side. That wasn't a bust. He meant to do it. But I saw some hesitation almost at the moment of truth. He might have wished he'd have handed it off.
He wound up under Jethro Pugh and Too Tall Jones. That's about 550 pounds. So now the Steelers have second and 12.
And Stallworth and Lynn Swann are flanked to the left of your screen.
Same side.
People.
Blitz is on. Overthrown. Bradshaw had to hurry. Good coverage against the blitz.
And solo coverage. Mel Renfro and Mark Washington stayed with their men and had them completely covered up. The ball was thrown away.
So it'll be third down as Frenchie Fuqua checks in place of Rocky Blyer. And Dallas makes mass substitutions in their defensive unit. Randy White, Randy Hughes, Calvin Peterson.
All right, you're going to get the three-man front. Remember that Frenchie Fuqua is not a great blocker, but he's a good pass receiver.
Franco Harris, one of the few runners who uses a mouthpiece. We just saw him shove in his mouth. Bradshaw back to pass. Pass is broken up by Mark Washington. Swan got a hand on it, but just touched it. And we'll see Chiarella again.
You know, he almost caught that ball.
I know it.
Lynn Swan. And as John McKay has said before, he just didn't have any good players at USC.
Yeah.
But O.J. Simpson and Swan and the different people he puts in here do a pretty good job, don't they?
That ball slipped out of Bradshaw's hand, perhaps just a bit. Chiarella again shading his eyes, but the sun's not usually a factor in kicking field goals. At the 23. This one, no good again. A little altercation. Jethro Pugh grabbed Cliff Harris and said, we need you.
Well, Jack Lambert was after Cliff Harris. That's the reason Jethro grabbed the defensive safety.
So Chiarella heads back to the sideline a little less confident than he might have been before this game started. 10-7 Dallas.
The second field goal. Now Lambert's walking by. Here's Harris telling him something and grabs the kicker. And Lambert at 6'5 works him over. From Ouachita, Arkansas to Jack Lambert, it's a long way to go, isn't it?
Long way up. Dallas takes it over at their own 20-yard line. White jumped and got back. First down for the Cowboys. Preston Pearson got some room, and Preston gets about 9. Good run by Preston Pearson, and Jack Lambert, who spent most of that last timeout talking to the officials, had to make the tackle. Hello from all over the country.
The thing you can never teach a running back, and Preston Pearson has always had the ability, is when not to be in too much of a hurry. He can get in behind people and let everything happen, and then just sort of start it out again. He did a beautiful job that time of finding what little hole there was.
Double tight ends for Dallas, Ron Howard and Billy Joe Dupree. Newhouse by Lambert. But I think he got the first down.
Well, Roger tried to call a false trap. He tried to pull the offensive right side of the line outside right. And I'll tell you, Lambert and company didn't buy it at all. They made a first down. They might have lost the player.
31.
Cowboys shotgun so far, when Staubach has chosen to use it, has not been too successful. 1 out of 4, 14 yards. First down in Dallas, they're on their own 31-yard line. Head handoff and nothing doing. It was hit almost as soon as he got the ball. Lambert again involved.
Hey,
really hot.
Pittsburgh defense from about the second period on has been really banging. Watch the action now, not only when the play is on, but right afterward. Here it is, snugged up tight. Newhouse gets drilled right away. That's Greenwood. Now watch Lambert, number 58. Man, they want the Cowboys bad.
Burton Wallace came across to trap Greenwood. Nobody was there. Newhouse did well to hold on to the ball at 2nd and 10. See how cautious Staubach is about throwing. Newhouse on a draw. Gets about 5. Jack Lambert and Mike Wagner. Watch Elsie Greenwood.
Now they finesse Ernie Holmes a little bit with this draw. They get Lambert caught just a little in between. Here he makes contact with Fitzgerald. And I'll tell you, Lambert may be biting people underneath the pile. I can't tell.
He is really hot about something. Still mad at Cliff Harris, I imagine.
How much money is involved, Patrick? I know you follow those kind of things.
$15,000 to the winner. $7,500 to the loser.
I'd bite you for 15 grand.
Not now. 3rd and 4. Blitz by the Steelers. Callback gets away from 1, gets away from 2. Is close to a first down. I don't know if he got it or not. And again, Jack Lambert. Look who's looking on. Behind Brent Musburger and Irv Cross, Walter Cronkite. There he is.
He looks a little colder than we do. I can't believe that. There's Walter. Of course, he sails a lot. That makes a difference. He's maybe not as used to it, huh?
He should be. Not a first down. Staubach did not quite get it. And the Dallas punting unit has come onto the field. Lambert, who has really been active of late, will stay on the special team.
And that was only Staubach's second carry. One of those was when he had to lose yardage, and he picked up four. Looks to me like Roger is not intending to run much. Maybe he's been told, don't take a chance. The Steelers, they put you on your shields.
Chuck Noll looking on alongside Terry Bradshaw, Glenn Edwards back to Pittsburgh along with Dave Brown. Edwards talking to the officials. Mitch Hupps in the game to punt for Dallas. But as we told you before, he is liable to do anything. Kyle Davis, by the way, is the snapper for Dallas, the rookie from Oklahoma. And a good one. Hupps catches a fine punt. It'll hang a long time. Dallas down in a hurry. Edwards got back to about the 24 after a 44-yard punt by Hupps. Bob Brunig again on the stop, along with Roland Woolsey. There goes Davis back to the Pittsburgh bench. It's still 10-7 Dallas.
Tom Landry, the Pittsburgh Steelers.
And their coach, Chuck Noll. Steeler ball, first and 10. Ball at their own 24. Swan comes in motion. Harris gets the handoff. Leroy Jordan, the first to hit. But you need help with Franco.
You almost feel like the Steeler defense, though, has turned on the entire ball club.
Down,
a ferocious series, really, the last time. They really beat up on Dallas on the defensive side, and that really helped the offensive unit. There's no doubt about it. Again, Blyers back in there, the blocker. Bradshaw hasn't left, has he?
Second and 7. No, he hasn't. Right now, he's in a passing situation. Harrison Blyer, the running backs. Outside, Swan. Never saw the ball coming. Completely done on reflex.
And the great thing about Bradshaw is that even though he throws a hot pass, it's easy to catch. Now, he's a very strong guy. I've watched him throw it 78 yards, just flat-footed. But look at this. It has a lot of spin on it. And Swan has those soft hands. 11 touchdown catches, but none today, not yet.
He's caught three for 97 yards. That tackle, of course, by Mark Washington, who's been with Swan all day and covered him well, but hasn't been able to stop him. Dallas in the ship, Bradshaw to Flyer. Flyer maybe two. L.C. Greenwood looking on from the sideline. One of the outstanding members of that Steel Curtain defense.
You know, his blocking of a couple of Fran Tarkenton passes a year ago might have taken a lot out of the Viking offense. He's so tall, he cuts off the whole right side of the field for the offensive quarterback.
He's 6'6". Second down for his Steel offensive unit right now. That's Sean Harris. Somebody got a hand on him, but he is tough to get down. Cliff Harris, again, had to make the tackle.
I'll tell you, Harvey Martin had a pretty good hand on him, too, and Franco just ripped it. Again, Franco's not looking for big daylight now. It's just that stutter step. It's a counter. Now, they get some pretty good wood on him, and Franco right now is just looking for yardage straight ahead, right over the top of Cliff Harris.
18 carries for 65 yards for Franco Harris. Right now, it's third, about a yard and a half. Might get it again, huh? Bradshaw's going to put it up. Ball hit up in the air. Larry Brown, the attendant receiver. Charlie Waters on the coverage, and a good pop from Waters.
A good call by Bradshaw. He thought he'd just bring him out, stop him, bring him across. Charlie Waters has played extremely well. I can recall against the Redskins that, you know, he was very high, and he's been a young man that's had operations, like seven of them in 6 years, but he's done a real good job.
Golden Richards back for Dallas. Bobby Walden to punt for Pittsburgh. Dallas has been trying to block these punts all day, and here they come again. Almost got it again, too. Richards signals for the fair catch at the 18. Henderson back close, and so was Cliff Harris to blocking that punt. I'm sorry. 34-yard kick by Walden.
And so, with 4 minutes and 6 seconds left in the third period, Dallas still leads 5-3. The toughest ticket in town and for a long time. The Super Bowl number 10. The Cowboys take it over. First and 10 at their own 20. Steve Furness replaces Joe Green in the Pittsburgh defense. Pearson goes in motion. There's Newhouse. Good yardage.
Pat, you want to see a guard and a tackle work together. Watch Blaine Nye and Rayfield Wright. You mentioned Furness, who just come in, who is a stunning defensive tackle. A little bit more action out of him than Joe Green because he's not as strong. Now watch the right part of your screen. 61 goes out, sets him up. Rayfield runs it. They wrote simple scissor block. Newhouse hits there just about right.
Takes a lot of timing, a lot more than it looks out. Second over, Staubach now. 6 yard pickup for Newhouse. Second and 4. Staubach gets to Pearson this time. Pearson gets out to about the 29. Short of a first down before L.C. Greenwood stops him.
If Pearson would happen to be the guy that's the big factor, wouldn't that be something that Tom Landry had the presence of mind to say, well, Pittsburgh has too many backs and I might not have as many, and I think I'll give Preston Pearson a shot.
Pearson's story, of course, is well known. He's played in Super Bowls with 3 different teams. With Pittsburgh, with Baltimore, and now with Dallas. Third and about a half yard. He may not have it. Andy Russell and L.C. Greenwood, the first two to hit him, but it's going to be close.
It's a pretty subtle thing, but I saw the entire line of scrimmage for the Steelers sort of take an inside move after the play had been set by Roger Staubach. They say you get the Super Bowls and you're the Super Bowl champions because of defense, and boy, the Steelers have done nothing to throw that one out the window.
Steelers, of course, trying to win 2 straight. It's been accomplished by the Dolphins and by the Packers and nobody else. Dallas, first down. In the insert, Tom Landry calling the play, telling Preston Pearson what he wants run on first down. Landry says, by the way, that the reason he always looks so serious when our cameras pick him up on the sideline is that he's thinking about what play he's going to call next. All that brings back to Pearson with no place to go. He fights for about 2. Dwight White.
Dallas has not done a lot of running of the football against this defense.
A very difficult defense to run against. Tom Henderson, who returned the opening kickoff after taking a handoff from Preston Pearson. Thank you, sir.
Super Bowl.
That's where you are, my friend.
Beautiful.
Second down now for Dallas. Doug Dennis in the deep back. Fakes to him. Outside, Newhouse has it. Newhouse up close to the first down marker and out of bounds by Andy Russell.
L.C. Greenwood just put the former Heisman Award winner, Maxwell Award winner, all the way down. Watch Roger go sort of a semi-roll inside after the fake. Gets it off, and L.C. knocked him down there as Newhouse made the catch. And then L.C. pulled him to his feet. A lot faster than Roger Willis.
I'm there. Stallings, who handles the secondary for Dallas.
But don't worry about that. You just backing him up. He's coming here. He's coming here, and he'll be in position to make a play. That's just a couple of change-ups.
That lunge by Newhouse got another Cowboy first down. A Staubach is back. He's going to take off of this one. Flag is down. Staubach got about 4.
He really took off that time, and the Steelers had come with a twist with the tackle going to the outside. So it opened the middle up. It's going to be interesting. There might be an offensive call against Newhouse to try to help from behind.
I think it's going to be a flip.
Newhouse tried to assist him, and Norm Schachter caught it.
That's only the second penalty of the game.
Now watch Roger Staubach go back and set up. Now notice the tackles will go to the outside, and it does open up the middle. Fitzgerald picks him up, and now Roger can't get outside. The Steelers have closed him off, and Newhouse did clip from behind. He hit Andy Russell.
There's DeMarco up against the Cowboys. Ball goes back to the 26-yard line, where it's still first down for Dallas. But in dangerous...
44! Clipping!
Pat,
Dallas!
You know that those Steeler linebackers, superb anyway, must have been working all the last 2 weeks at least on do not let Rogers set you up and get outside.
Watch the clip.
All right, let's... That's not a clip. That's a good block. The clip took place a little bit later on down there with... Hey, Roger.
Try to show it to you again in a minute. Right now, the back line. Staubach is back to pass. Sammy's got a lot of time. Staubach out of bounds at the 31.
You know something, he has really come a long way in knowing when not to challenge people. Here he's trying to get back, and Newhouse just takes Andy Russell right on through.
That was the play before. Now we're back to second down after a scramble by Staubach. He still has 17 to go for first down. Dwight White and Jack Ham took him out of bounds.
This is not an enviable position. I wouldn't like to be trying to pick up 17 yards, particularly all at once.
Second down for the Cowboys. Things have quieted down considerably since the quarter. Newhouse the call on a draw play with nowhere to go. He fell for perhaps a yard before Lambert and Ham were close by.
And Dwight White. Steelers right now, their defensive unit, I think, is really taking it to the Cowboys. You can ask Robert Newhouse. He's getting a rest because of it.
Dallas began this game like they were going to try every play that had ever been diagrammed on any blackboard. But they've become very conservative. We have just 30 seconds left in the third period. They still lead. Dallas does.
Shotgun.
Shotgun. Here it is. See how much time he has. A lot. Caught by Dennison. Oh, wait a minute. It's Pearson. Passing downs are his downs. Mel Blunt on the stop.
Pearson's caught 9 passes in the last 2 playoff games. The big thing about the shotgun or spread is you get 5 receivers downfield right now.
And Staubach has a longer look at him. That's the end of the third quarter of Super Bowl X with the score. Is in the game.
You know, he was born the year I broke into professional football. He's young.
Well, so are you. You think young. Kick is fair. Bounces. Handled by the Steelers. Cover! I think Pittsburgh got it back. Yes, they did. Dave Brown tried to handle it. 36-yard kick from Hubs. Dallas almost got another break.
I believe Kyle Davis and Edwards were down there to crack him rather early.
Again, those pictures that you've been seeing from above the Orange Bowl from the Goodyear blimp. And by the way,
good friend who's been working with us for years, Jim Newcomb, PR man.
I wonder if they're going to be able to get that thing on the ground tonight. That wind's blowing pretty hard.
Bradshaw back to pass. Lots of time. Wide open is Harris. Andrew Harris is out of bounds. Out of bounds. Back at the 40-yard line. He was gone.
Wasn't he? Franco made it to the end zone just in case. Super throw by Terry Bradshaw. Off the wrong leg like a single-wing tailback. Watch this now. You're behind the Dallas defense. Gregory's putting pressure on. There goes Harvey after him. Now he puts it away. Now watch this throw. Off the wrong leg and right on the money. And Franco just does step out right in front of his own bench. And he did.
He just did step on the white. That, of course, is out of bounds. Want to see it again? Watch this. Harris, there's his foot out of bounds. Right there. A legal catch because he took 2 steps inbounds. 26-yard pickup for the Steelers after the Dallas 43, after their own 43. Brad
Bradshaw again is going to air it out. Deep. Too deep. Covered by Mel Renfro, but he had a step. Allworth is deceiving. 6'2", 185.
Runs a super post pattern, which he just ran, and Cowboys are in a lot of single solo coverage right now. They're keeping people under, but Bradshaw's frequency was right. He was open, and he simply missed it.
That win that we've been talking about throughout the afternoon looks right now as if it's at the back of the Steelers. Sometimes it's hard to tell from up here. It swirls. Second and 10 for Pittsburgh. Harris was hit as soon as he got the ball. Hit hard by Jethro Pugh. And tempers are starting to flare just a little bit on both sides. Norm Schachter saying, hey, let's quiet it down a little bit.
Now we're going to get the three-man rush, Pat. We've got Randy White, the rookie All-American, the number one draft. We've got a lot of number one draft choices. But remember, Dallas did not get here with rookies. They got here with the veteran ball club.
They got six linebackers in the game right now. Pittsburgh's third down efficiency is 6-12. That's the situation they face right now. Only a three-man rush. Randy White chasing Bradshaw. Oh, got him. Good play by Randy White.
Number 54 runs a 4-6 40. And think about that. He weighs 250. And he's Andre.
Gregory came over to make sure, but watch White again.
Well, remember, Bradshaw is a very, very quick quarterback. Sets up to the left of your screen. Randy misses it. And now watch the recovery. Look out, Terry.
Gregory, of course, number 77, came over to help out. And so Bobby Walden checks into the Steeler lineup to punt. Good snap. Dallas trying to set up a return. But Walden really got a hold of this one. Richards handles. Away from Garrett so far and can't get quite around the corner. Chased by Davis and out of bounds by Sam Davis. 57-yard punt off the toe of Bobby Walden.
And you know, there was a real good play on that, because had Billy Joe Dupre made the block for him, it would have been a clip, and then the Dallas Cowboys would have been in the hole.
They lead by three.
Feeling here is the Cowboys got to get some offensive something going. They better get these Steelers off their back, and they're deep in their own territory, and Pittsburgh has the win this last period.
13 minutes, 11 seconds left in the football game as Roger Staubach has a first down. Throw back to Roger. Nobody open, and he wisely tucked it away. They didn't fool anybody. They were looking for Drew Pearson way down the far sideline, but J.T. Thomas was right there.
Stride for stride. Again, remember that Roger can take the lateral. Here he is from a regular team. He hands it off legally and now takes the flea flicker back from Preston. But I'll tell you something, J.T. had Drew Pearson covered all the way.
A good play by Staubach. That's Bell Blunt covering Golden Richards, if you can call it that.
That's exactly what I call it. Beautifully played. Beautiful execution.
Second down for Dallas. Pearson comes in motion. The handoff goes to Dennison, and he gets nothing. Steve Furness, Jack Lambert, and Mike Wagner.
Steeler down four now are getting penetration. Elsie Greenwood did not please that young lady, but they are beginning to really sort of go over the top right now.
And so it becomes third down. Watch this, Golden Richards. Going to try to get even. Hasn't so far.
They're just trying to get each other's attention, I guess.
I think they got it. A third down play, and no shift this time. They just line up in the shotgun. Ballback is going to go back with him. Furness right with him. Holmes took a shot and missed. Greenwood and White took him down. And Furness. Dallas is in trouble right now, I think.
Big factor, you're right. The big factor, Ernie Holmes, number 63, who just patted Roger, really made the big penetration early. Pittsburgh is turned on.
And so
so is Chuck Dole, their head coach. Mitch Hupps will have to punt against the wind.
Defense!
This time back by himself is Glenn Edwards for the Steelers. Hupps standing at his own goal line. Dallas leads it 10-7 with 11:40 left now in the fourth period. They're trying to block it. And in. Out of the end zone. It's 10-9. Safety. Blocked by Reggie Harrison. And the Steelers close to within 1 point.
And Dallas will have to give up the football. Here it is. Right up the middle.
Right up the middle came Reggie Harrison, a backup running back from the University of Cincinnati. Out of the end zone, of course, is an automatic safety.
Looked to me like that Hupps took a lot of time getting that one placed on the foot for kicking from the 2 yard line.
Watch it again.
Here you can see it. Hupps took a lot of time. The rookie from Arizona really laid that one down almost deliberately. And luckily, it went out of the end zone.
Of course, if it had stayed in and the Steelers had recovered, it would have been a touchdown. But as it flew out of the end zone, it's an automatic safety. It's Dallas 10, Pittsburgh 9. Now they get the free kick.
But again, you give up the football to get it. And I've never seen a safety that didn't result in something awful for the team that had it happen to him.
Mitch Hupps now can't come across the 20-yard line. They choose to punt, of course, because you can't use a tee. Otherwise, they might place kick it. Here goes Hupps. It'll hang up there a long time. Collier takes it at the 30. They got something going here. Collier blasts to the 45-yard line of Dallas. Stopped by Bob Grimmie. But the Steelers are floating right now.
All right, Pat, I've been in this situation before. In a championship game right now, the pressure on the defense is almost unbearable. You don't want to make the one big play to cost you the game, and therefore you sometimes don't gamble enough and play your normal defense. The Cowboys have got to have the best defensive series of maybe their lives.
Just outside the 45 in Dallas territory. Bradshaw sets him down. Cowboys go to the flex. Harris looking to go to the outside. Gets away from one and gets about five on his own.
But notice how the pursuit did not get there. You're right behind the Dallas defense. Leroy Jordan has already gone to cover. This big fella makes it look so easy. This is not a dummy scrimmage play. That's Franco Harris against the Dallas Cowboys.
Harris now 20 carries for 69 yards as Bradshaw breaks him out in a hurry. Second and four. Meyer gets the call this time, and he is close to a first down.
Meyer the ball.
Offensive line for the Steelers again, really popping off the ball. Watch Franco block.
All right, he returns the favor. Blyer does it for him a lot. Let's watch Franco Harris. Is he a complete football player? That isn't a shabby block. Good job.
Block on D.D. Lewis. Dallas, one-point lead. Looks shaky right now. There's the Pittsburgh defense. White, looking on. Third and about a foot. Picture tells you the story of what he's thinking.
Be careful on short yardage defenses.
Shaw taking no chances, gives to Harris, and again he gets outside. Cliff Harris takes him out of bounds. They got the first down with lots to spare.
Shows you how fast he is, though, Pat. Actually, Mel Renfro had a good chance to see you on the outside and tackle him. And Franco gets beyond you so quickly, you just misjudge his speed. Look at Mel Renfro, right? All right, he got rid of the block by Blyer. Cliff Harris just can't get up there quickly enough.
Blyer and Harris, who blocked so well for each other, give the Steelers a first down inside the Dallas 30. Meyer again gets the ball. No place to go this time. Ed Jones, the first man to hit him, and I mean hit it.
Jethro sort of spun Meyer around and hung him up. little too tall, finished him off.
Comes Mullins into the game. And Jim Plant comes out. Mullins plays right guard. Davis plays left guard. Both speed receivers, Swan and Stallworth, split wide to the right. For Bradshaw on second and long, he's got to throw. Going to take off with it himself. Bradshaw fumbles out of bounds. Still Steeler ball.
Well, he is strong. He ran right through D.D. Lewis. Didn't make any more yardage, but he wasn't giving himself up at all. Watch this now. The backs go left to throw, so he goes right. The linebackers have dropped off to help. D.D. hit him a good shot. Could have marked Washington. He walked right through both of them.
A 9-yard pickup for Bradshaw on that run. Chuck Noll with instructions to Swan as he puts an extra tight end into the game and takes Swan out. Third and one. 9 minutes to play. Bradshaw was out of bounds with that fumble, so the clock is stopped. He and Harris collide, but Harris still got the first down. Very, very close to it.
Look at Terry Bradshaw. He's making contact with so darn many people. Maybe he thought Franco was on the other side. With Harris, it's give him the ball and get lost.
Indication from the Steeler offensive unit that they did not get the first down. It's about a foot short. Chuck Noll has indicated no Roy Chirilla. Not this time. Let's go for it. Now Bradshaw asked him to measure. 8 minutes, 54 seconds left in the game. Super Bowl 10 started off with a bang. Both teams with big plays in the first period. Since then, it's become a defensive battle.
That's absolutely the reason we have not seen scoring, though. I have never seen a game with so many great defensive plays when they had to be made.
Here comes Girella. Remember now, the Steelers trail by just one. It's 10-9. Girella has missed twice already. And ironically, from this same distance, 26 yards, 36 when you add the extra 10 for the goalpost being back. But that was at the other end of the field.
Roy,
the swirling wind.
If Roy misses this one, he may not go back to Pittsburgh.
This time he doesn't. Pittsburgh 12, Dallas 10. Girella finally accepting congratulations gives his team the lead as they try to win their second consecutive Super Bowl. Pittsburgh 12, Dallas 10. Girella set to kick off for the Pittsburgh Steelers, who have just taken the lead. 12-10 on his field goal. Doug Dennison and Pearson deep for Dallas. Going to be Pearson. He got it back wisely.
Calvin Peterson, though, the young linebacker, backed into Pearson, and Preston took his eyes off the ball. What do you say to a young man? Just get away from it. I'm the guy that's supposed to bring it back.
As a result, the Cowboys get the ball at their own 15-yard line. With 8 minutes and 32 seconds left in the game, Pittsburgh 12, Dallas 10. Not been able to do much on offense for the entire second half. Total offense so far, in fact, is just 159 yards. The Steelers have 104. Roger Staubach behind for the first time. He's going to throw. Down the middle, picks off. Now the Steelers, Mike Wagner, and down to the 5-yard line.
Whoa! The name of the game is defense. There's Wagner, 4 interceptions this year.
Burton Lawless, number 66, dragging his right arm. The Steelers and that defensive unit turn it over again. There goes Lawless.
And you know, Wagner backed off of it, let Roger throw the ball down the middle, and then he came charging. There was no doubt about coverage. He was going for the ball. Watch this. Now watch Lawless setting up for him. He's the one that got hurt. Wagner's heading for the goal line.
Really heading in that direction. Inside the 10, down to about the 6. First and goal, Pittsburgh. Flyer gets the ball. Flyer inside the 5 to the 4.
stopped by Ed Jones and Cliff Harris. Watch that play develop.
All right, you're in close now. There's Jethro Pugh trying to get through. Too tall is really held off. Good job by Gravel. There's a lot of contact here. Rocky Blyer is drilled. Boy, I'll tell you, the Cowboys are in trouble.
Second and goal at the four for Pittsburgh. They beat up on Minnesota in last year's Super Bowl. Now they're doing it to Dallas. Bradshaw looks to the outside. Bradshaw to the two. Leroy Jordan and Ed Jones stopped him. Actually, he's close to the one-yard line.
I'll tell you, bad knee and all, Bradshaw's darn quick. Watch him. He liked to bootleg this thing all the way to the side. He's cut off and almost killed right here. You can see the eyes of Mel Renfro on him. He's a winning quarterback. Make no mistake.
Meyer came back to block for him. And now it's third and goal for Bradshaw on the Steeler offensive unit. He hits to Harris. Harris doesn't get in. Fumble! Gotta try another field goal now. Cowboy defensive unit equal to the occasion. They thought they recovered.
I think Too Tall Jones is the one that sort of strips him of it. But even Mark Washington, the secondary man's in there. Let's see who comes across. Leroy Jordan. And the ball is alive. Look at this. Comes right back to Franco Harris.
Harris recovered his own fumble. Now Girella with Walden holding. That's a nine. 19 yards out. He is good again. 15-10 now. Boy, Girella, after missing two, has made two.
Now we should add a little caution, though, Pat, because the Cowboys came back.
10, Pittsburgh leads. The deep men for Dallas, Doug Dennison on the left. Preston Pearson on the right. Roy Girella to kick off for the Steelers. Cowboys will get it back with just over 6.5 minutes remaining. A high kick in the direction of Pearson. Back up the middle he comes. Oh. Hit hard by Reggie Harrison, who blocked the putt earlier. A good job on the special team. Randy Grossman helped out on the tackle.
We can't give Reggie the MVP of the Super Bowl, but he's done a heck of a lot to turn it around.
Sure does, as the chant of defense goes up to the Steeler contingent of fans at the Orange Bowl in Super Bowl 10. Al Lindsay right on the opposite sideline.
Now, we don't have to replay what happened up in Bloomington, Minnesota, or even get into what some people think is a controversy, but they pull them out before, and a wild card team in the finals has that little something going for them. They've got to be careful on defense.
Right now, they've got the ball at their own 24-yard line. Dallas first down. Starback going to air it out. Screen pass. Right hand missed. He got caught from behind by Steve Furness. Dallas, a very good screening team. They got about 5 yards on that.
Roger didn't get the ball to Newhouse quite as quickly as he wanted to. He was being very deliberate, but the ball stayed up there a long time, and I think Robert could almost feel Jack Ham coming, you know? Watch this now. They play it pretty well. They're almost actively blocking on the line of scrimmage, but watch the ball just sort of hang, barely get over Greenwood. And now Newhouse is in a little bit of traffic that he didn't particularly want.
Burton Wallace is back in the game. Problems the last series. Dwight White is loose chasing Roger. He didn't get him. They finally did, though. L.C. Greenwood, Ernie Holmes, and Furness all in the active chase for Staubach.
Now, White sort of injured his ankle on that play. He's walking it off. Watch how quickly he shows. Neely just lost the block. Roger somehow pulls this one off. And now the former midshipman's got a little bit of a problem. Roll it.
Now Preston Pearson and Charles Young are the running backs for Dallas. Passing situations, that's the combo they like. Third and 15, though, they don't like that. Shotgun.
Go, go, go!
going to swarm on him before he gets a first down. And Dallas will have to kick.
Well, and I'll tell you, that Pittsburgh secondary is banging every receiver, whether they catch the ball or not. Again, Roger waited a long time to hit his safety valve, Charlie Young in the flat. He was open all the way from the formation's beginning.
Greenwood and Lambert involved in the tackle. That looks like it could be Drew Pearson that's hurt.
Well, Glenn Edwards, I saw Glenn Edwards sock him pretty hard, and Golden is down.
That is Golden Richards, and not Drew Pearson.
Remember, the receivers sometimes are looking for places to go, and a belligerent secondary can catch a guy when he's looking back for the quarterback. I think that's what happened to Golden. But he's been fighting with at least one of the guys most of the afternoon.
Been fighting with Mel Blunt for the most part.
Well, you know, the Pittsburgh secondary is at the right age. They're all five-year veterans or six. The perfect time to play excellent secondary. Now, watch to the left of your screen. There the circle is. Okay, now follow it. There's Glenn Edwards working. I think Golden is pinned to the mat. He's hurt, too. Let's see what happens on this. The officials did not drop a flag.
At any rate, Golden Richards is still down. Tom Landry is still concerned. They lost their regular starting tight end, Gene Fugit, in the first half, and he hasn't come back. Billy Joe Dupree has been the tight end ever since.
So that last play doesn't look like maybe there should have been a flag involved. I think when both people are exchanging that way, it's pretty much, you know, who ends up on the deck. Obviously, the Super Bowl champion coach didn't mind it. Rogers not even going to get the fourth down play. They've got to kick it.
Staubach's arm skimmed by the artificial surface. The orange ball and Franco Harris on the other side of the field looking on. Golden Richards, by the way, is up now and being assisted from the field. Still talking to some members of the Pittsburgh secondary. Couldn't prepare here. Fitzgerald and Ralph Neely, of course, veteran from Oklahoma.
I tell you, that little fellow from Hawaii right there, Golden Richards, has really been the big play fella. You hear a lot about Drew Pearson, but this young man actually started him back against the Redskins, but Dallas wouldn't even be here.
Dallas is going to have to punt with 4 minutes and 50 seconds left in the football game. Richards to the sideline now. Back deep for the Steelers, Glenn Edwards and Dave Brown. This time hangs it very high, and Edwards is going to run it. Comes almost around the corner, gets outside the 30, and Bradshaw and his group now need a couple of first downs. 47-yard kick. Tackle made by Kyle Davis, who snapped the ball. The clock tells you the story. It's Pittsburgh 15, Dallas 10.
All right, you used to room with Charlie Connerly. What's the quarterback thinking now? Against the defense, what are you not trying to do as the Pittsburgh quarterback?
I'm thinking about not throwing an interception, not turning it over at this time without getting too conservative. First and 10 for the Steelers. Ball at their own 30. He gives to Harris, and Harris is stopped after about two by Jethro Pugh. Still running, 4:10 left on the clock now. That's how much left in the game. That's how many seconds the Steelers have to steal before they become the third team to win back-to-back Super Bowl championships.
Dallas will be tackling the football.
Golden Richards. Second down, Pittsburgh down. Harris again gets the call. Met in the hole by Leroy Jordan. Ed Jones also assisted. They need about five for a clutch first down right here.
I guess if you had to pivot the entire game, which you can't do, if you had to pivot on one play, I would say this one is a big one, a large play. Third down and five right on the button.
Packed house at the Orange Bowl from the beginning is still here. Harris, 25 carries now for 82 yards. He carried 34 times last year, you recall.
Here's Bradshaw. Bothered from behind. Len Swan is open. Got it. Steeler touchdown. Mark Washington with him. The Cowboys had the safety clipped on. 64-yard touchdown pass from Bradshaw to Len Swan, and Bradshaw is down.
Bradshaw is down, but he threw the ball about 65 yards, and he threw it a ton. Now he's on his feet. He's got a long time to rest up. That's got to be one of the great passes in Super Bowl history or in pro football history.
Dallas had a blitz going. Let's look at it again.
All right, here he is, number 12. He does not like the play pass, and what difference does it make now? It's a run by the blitz, Mel Renfro, man. Here it is. And Len Swan does it again. Mark Washington's there, but he's in the wake by about a step and a half.
Swan has now caught four passes for 161 yards. Bobby Walden to hold it. Bradshaw on the sideline. No good. No good. Off the foot of Roy Girella. It hits the left upright. So it's 21-10. Steelers over the Cowboys. Tom Brookshire is starting to leave the booth to go to the winning dressing room.
You look
at the Goodyear blimp, so kind to us all day. And as Tommy goes down to what looks like it'll be the Pittsburgh locker room, a new man puts on the headset. A guy who's been in these situations a lot of times. Welcome, Hank Stram.
Thank you very much, Pat.
Here's that last catch, Hank.
To get behind, in good shape, the ball is thrown right over the shoulder perfectly. Terrific concentration by Swan. And, of course, he makes the reception, goes all the way in for the score.
That is a Super Bowl mark, by the way, the four catches for 161 yards by Swan. The old record set 1967 by Max McGee. Girella's kick is going to go deep in the end zone. Andrew Pearson just downs it there. Preston Pearson, I beg your pardon. There's Terry Bradshaw. His work has been done. Henderson shaken up on the kickoff. And Terry Hanratty starts to loosen his shoulders. He'll be throwing too much, though, I don't think, Hank.
No. They'll try to use up as much time as they possibly can, I'm sure, the next time they get possession.
The preliminary report on Bradshaw is that it appears to be a concussion. Remember, he had a bad knee coming in, but he is holding the back of his head, so I guess concussion is right. That's the book on Bradshaw for today.
This is the one position that you don't like to be in against the Pittsburgh Steelers, and that is to have to throw the ball consistently because they do such a great job of rushing that passer.
That pass from Stavak was complete to Young. Golden Richards did not come back, by the way. Percy Howard is the other wide receiver. Percy, number 81. You think Dallas started to go conservative too soon, Coach?
As you watched the game, you had the feeling that they were sitting on that just very small lead, and that's always a disaster, really, because especially when you're a great offensive team like they are, they do a lot of things well offensively, and they seemingly got away from the pattern that they normally execute.
Pass complete to Drew Pearson out of bounds in front of the Cowboy bench.
They threw very seldomly on first down, for example. Here's a shot from the shotgun.
30-yard pickup gives the Cowboys a first down. They trail by 11. J.T. Thomas on the coverage right there.
Yes, and the receiver knew exactly where he was, kept his feet in bounds, and a big play for Dallas.
So Roger Staubach now going back to the air, picks up a first down. 2 minutes, 8 seconds left as Pearson went out of bounds. There goes Bradshaw. Possible concussion. Shotgun for Dallas again. Outside caught by Pearson.
This time, Preston Pearson. Andy Russell closest. Bradshaw, quite an athlete.
Great tribute to a great athlete, really, the way he played out here this afternoon. A tremendous competitor. He really makes it happen, doesn't he, Pat?
Very exciting player. Here's that last completion. Comes Pearson. That's Howard. And that's Pearson out of bounds with the catch. First down, Dallas. They stop the clock again with 2 minutes, 3 seconds to go. Howard left, Pearson right. Shotgun again. Ball back from behind by Dwight White.
They doubled the outside receivers that time, and the only one that had a chance was the tight end, and they had him faded pretty well, too.
So with that sack by Staubach, if you could call it that, the two-minute warning is given to both sides. Pittsburgh 21, Dallas 10. Now as Tom Brookshire has gone to the winning locker room, which now looks like it'll be the locker room of the Pittsburgh Steelers for the second year in a row. However, Coach, if you look at that scoreboard and the time left, it's not over yet.
Well, it's a long way from being over. There's a lot of time, as you mentioned, a minute 56 seconds. Cowboys have to get in and score a touchdown in this drive if they hope to get back into this game.
Staubach looking deep and throwing deep.
Oh, pass interference.
Touchdown, Dallas.
I guess they didn't call it either.
Jersey Howard, Mel Blunt got tangled up with Howard, and the Cowboys aren't out of it yet. Staubach, 34-yard touchdown pass to Percy Howard.
See if we get a picture of the, it looked like there was definitely pass interference on Blunt, but it doesn't make any difference. It's still, you don't see it.
Let's come back and look at it again and see if we can.
Here's another shot of it. Here's Percy Howard. No, it wasn't too bad. Looked worse at the time than it actually was.
You're so right.
Yep.
He just went by Blunt.
Yes, he did.
When he looked back, Frisch hits the extra point with Waters holding.
Well, they're back in business.
Yes, sir. It's 21-17. Roger Staubach just hoping that his defensive unit can get the ball back with 1:48 left in this game. It's Pittsburgh 21, Dallas 17. And right now, I guess our crew that's going to do the postgame show better stand in between the locker rooms and not go either place.
That's right.
Dallas has that much time left, and of course, so do the Steelers. You're thinking onside kick right here, of course. I watched Pittsburgh in the workouts yesterday, and they worked on onside kicks just over and over and over again, especially after Oakland was successful against them.
But the funny thing about an onside kick is the ball bounces so funny that a lot of times you just don't know, regardless how much you rehearse it, if it ricochets off a Pittsburgh player or takes a funny bounce, you know, all the practice in the world doesn't do any good.
I guess the best thing you can do in a situation like that is say, don't try to pick it up, just get on top of it.
Just make sure you fall on it, that's right.
That's difficult too. Here's Frisch ready to go. Onside kick comes this way. Pittsburgh has it, he made sure that time. As Gary Mullins had picked it up, number 72, they had him in there because although he's an offensive guard, tackle, or whatever, he still got the good hand.
That kick took a perfect bounce, ready for Pittsburgh, and it was very easy to handle it, which was very obvious.
Producer of this game has been Robert Stinner, and what a job he's done in the midst of all the confusion and hoopla that goes on. Able job, as always, by Sandy Grossman. There have been a lot of distractions for all of us. Those two guys have been super, too. Perry Hanratty is the Pittsburgh quarterback. A minute 47 still on the clock. Harris just hoping to hang on to the ball.
He's got to call a timeout.
Leroy Jordan, the captain, signals timeout. Also like to give credit, too, to Bill Friel. He's done such a great job spotting, and Jim Krauser, who's handled the statistics so well. Dallas burns a timeout, as you would expect. A minute 41 seconds left on the scoreboard clock. Jordan goes over to talk to Landry, but he's got some words for Staubach first. 21-17 the score. Steelers were about a touchdown favorite. They got behind early to Dallas, but their defense kept putting the squeeze on the Cowboy offensive unit.
There's no question about the fact that Pittsburgh is undoubtedly one of the fine defensive teams that's played in the National Football League for a long, long time.
Well, a long terrific. Time is right.
Just terrific.
Don't forget, coming up as soon as we're through here, we'll go to the locker room as soon as the game is over. That's the timeout situation. Go to the locker rooms for a big post-game show, and then we'll join the final round of the Phoenix Open. Right now, second down for the Steelers. Terry Hanratty, the quarterback, with Meyer and Harris, the running back. Harris swings to the outside. The Cowboys can't tear the ball loose. They tried to. Jones and Martin, the two defensive ends. Chuck Noll looking on. Third down and 10 now. Dallas has used another timeout. They have one left, and Hanratty this time comes over to talk to Noll.
Wouldn't be surprised to see him run some kind of a wide play to use up as much time as possible.
Hanratty hasn't had too much playing time over the course of the year. Chuck Noll obviously just saying, hang on to it, whatever you do. Don't take any chances. Third down, 10 for the Steelers. Don't do anything that might stop the clock. He might be able to capitalize on. 21-17, Pittsburgh over Dallas. Super Bowl 10.
Looks like they might run to the left where they're lined up, Pat.
That's what they do. They head up the middle. Yep. Stopped, and Dallas uses it last time out. Jethro Pugh and Leroy Jordan. Rocky Blyer, the ball carrier. And Dallas will get another chance with no timeouts left. They've used them all.
You don't suppose they'll try to block this kick, do you?
I wasn't even going to ask you that.
Probably had everybody but the coaching staff going after this kick.
Here comes Hanratty back in the game. And looks like they're not going to kick.
I think they're going to run out of time. They're going to go for it.
They're going to try to run up and run out as much time as they can.
Yeah.
It is fourth down. Got about 8 yards to go. Got a minute and 28 seconds left in Super Bowl 10.
They're going to run right this time, looks like, where they're lined up. Here they come.
Here they come with Meyer to the right. Dallas stops it. No first down. The Cowboys will take it over. A minute, 22 seconds. Cowboy offensive unit, of course, hustles onto the field. Andy Russell, the Pittsburgh Steeler defensive captain, says, come on, let's go. A minute, 22 seconds still left on the clock. The Steelers 21, Cowboys 17. Dallas ball at their own 38-yard line. A long way to go with no timeouts left. They got to work the sidelines, no question about it. Scoreboard clock is official, by the way.
Psychologically, Pat, the Cowboys have to feel good about the way things worked out in that last series because they got a much shorter field to work from than they would have had they kicked.
But you do. That's one we've got to ask Chuck Noll about. Right away, Starback goes to the shotgun. He doesn't bother. Bad snap. Picked it up on the hop. Take off with it and try to get out of bounds, I think. No, he didn't. He got a first down close to midfield. Clock shows a minute 10 left and still running. The Cowboys hustle back. The Steelers obviously won't do that.
You know, Pugh at that time was open in the middle. They're doubling the outside people. Looks like the tight end or the backs might have an opportunity in the seams. If they're going to complete one here on this drive.
Down to 50 seconds left as we start this play. Staubach handles the low snap again. Everybody downfield in the coverage. Roger throws. Preston Pearson did not get out of bounds. He went straight ahead. 40 seconds left on the clock now. Down to the Steeler 37-yard line.
You know, units hustle back.
That time, Billy Joe Dupree was wide open down the middle, but Roger didn't see him.
Now the ball gets loose and the clock is stopped. Now we start it again, does Norm Schachter, with 25 seconds left. Staubach in the shotgun. He'll get it with 20 seconds to go. Again, a low snap. He got away. Staubach fires down the middle. Overthrew. They've got 12 seconds left on the clock. Drew Pearson was covered by Clint Edwards. Staubach fired down the middle. I don't know how he got out of the front.
Yeah, it was good thinking on his part. He had good presence. Because had he not thrown the ball, he'd have probably blown all the time that he had left. But he stopped the clock. A good play with 12 seconds left in the clock.
A low snap from the center, John Fitzgerald, almost caused complete disaster. It almost caused the game to be over. 12 seconds on the scoreboard clock. Possibly time for two, but no more plays than that. The Pittsburgh 38. Roger Staubach with perhaps the last play of this year. Good snap this time.
Three-man rush.
High, high. Intended for Howard.
Jump ball in the end zone. It's a jump ball in the end zone. Yep, 3 seconds.
One more.
Yep.
That's the only thing to do.
They got one more shot just like that. Hope and a prayer.
Something like that. Maybe you hope to out-jump him. Maybe you hope for a ricochet.
That's right. Or hopefully maybe a pass interference.
Too bad he doesn't have R.C. Owens. Remember him?
That's what he needs. Yeah, the old alley-oop. Otis Taylor. Our Otis Taylor was great at jumping, out-leaping people and making that kind of a play. We like to throw to him on a one-on-one situation.
Let's look at that last play, that last jump ball.
Receivers really have to have excellent concentration in that kind of play, too, just in case it ricochets, so they can get it on the rebound.
This, most certainly, the last play of Super Bowl X, unless we have a penalty. Staubach pumps and fires.
That's all.
Picked off in the end zone by Glenn Edwards, and he's going to bring it out. This one is over. Edwards is down at the 28, and the Steelers repeat. Of Super Bowls come to an end with Pittsburgh's shot goal. A repeat champion. They beat Minnesota last year, and now they have defeated the wild card teams in the NFC, the Dallas Cowboys, coached by Tom Landry.
Well, it's a great compliment to both teams to play in this game, and of course, a terrific compliment to Chuck Noll and the Pittsburgh Steelers. It's difficult to win it the first time, Pat, as you know, but even more difficult to come back and win it the second time. So it's a great compliment to these people.
Certainly the mark of a great team. They head for the locker rooms. The confusion, of course, as Pittsburgh heads for their locker room, and the quiet of what the Dallas dressing room would be like. So, for Tom Brookshire, Hank Stram, this is Pat Summerall saying again, the final score at Super Bowl X, Pittsburgh 21, Dallas 17.
X was sponsored by AC Delco, Division of General Motors. Quality automotive parts and quality motoring with a name you know, AC Delco. Goodyear tires and Goodyear service for good years in your car. And by Ford and your local Ford dealer, who invite you to check out the values during their limited edition sale beginning tomorrow. The Super Bowl today will continue after this word from your local station. The Super Bowl today is sponsored by Schlitz. There's just one beer, Schlitz. You know it.
Are we on
the set? Well, back here at Super Bowl 10, the joyous celebration. We're about to be swarmed over by Pittsburgh Steelers fans. Walter Cronkite is here. And Walter, how do you enjoy this scene?
Well, I think we've got a whole new thing here for you folks with the being right out on the field practically. Obviously, it's going to be an interesting kind of an interview situation you do here.
Are you scared at all, Walter, these Pittsburgh fans around you? You're a little nervous with all these Pittsburgh fans around you.
Well, just as long as we don't let them know we're for Dallas at the moment, right? It was a great football game, though, wasn't it?
Oh, Walter, it was marvelous.
And let's, while we got a chance, I'll invite you to my box at the Super Bowl of Politics. Madison Square Garden in July, Kansas City in August, right?
Walter, we'll all be there. Thank you very much.
Great game. Thanks for being with you.
Everybody is so curious about why Chuck Knoll didn't punt. Let's go to the locker room and Tommy Brookshire right now.
Tommy is still getting his mic fixed. We have here the coach, Chuck Knoll, and Pete Rozelle, and I'm sure he has something very important to give to Chuck Knoll and the Pittsburgh Steelers.
I think one of the important things, Commissioner, is what the trophy says for the Super Bowl champions.
Now, this is the Vince Lombardi trophy for Super Bowl X. And it goes to Dan Rooney here, the Rooney family, the president of the Steelers, and to Chuck Knoll. Dan, it took your family 40 years to win a championship, and now it seems like you don't want to ever lose one. It's the second in a row, and I think it's a great tribute to your father, to you and your brother Art, so instrumental in management and the scouting, this outstanding coach, Chuck Knoll, and certainly a magnificent group of football players who played under pressure all year, particularly today. And I know that you have to be very, very proud of your organization, and you should be, Dan, for you and Chuck.
Well, we really do. This is really an honor for me to be able to receive this for this football team. This team has really done just an outstanding job this year, and they have come on, played under a lot of duress and hardship, and it was great, and they've done it all the way.
Come on, duress and hardship. It's a super squad, and you guys put it together. We're going to ask the coach about how do you get 21 the hard way. Take him there, Sonny, will you?
I tell you, Coach, I've never seen 21 the hard way, and that's a commissioner's line. He said 21 points the hard way. It certainly was.
Well, we planned it that way. We figured we'd get that safety, and that would take care of everything.
I tell you, it was a great football game, one of the best as far as big plays by especially your defense. I tell you, Coach, I've never seen a defensive team that they, after the fumble snap from center on the punt, what you did from then on, your defense certainly controlled it.
Well, our defense has played super for us all year. They've played well for us in the seasons past, but they have played exceptionally well in this playoff series. We've played this game fumbling a lot in hardships, and I think that's what Dan was referring to. And they never get their dauber down. They just hang in there no matter what happens. They feel they have the ability to come in there and stop whoever tries to do something.
Any big surprises today from their offense?
No, not really. They did about what we expected, and the same thing defensively. They're a good, tough, hard football team. I thought the difference in the game was going to be who could make the big play, and we were able to make some big plays defensively, and of course, Lynn Swann's catch and Terry Bradshaw's great throw standing in there under pressure. It was a safety blitz on, as you probably know, and We were able to pick him up pretty well, and Terry just let that thing fly, and you either get killed or...
You certainly do. Coach, I know you want to get out and celebrate with your players. Congratulations again. A great victory.
All right, Sonny, I'm staying over here with Lynn Swan, a fellow that John McKay said all he did was win football games for SC. Lynn, you came in here with your bell rung. You didn't think you felt very well. You didn't like your reactions to the couple of weeks, and I've never seen a receiver have a better day in Super Bowl or any time else. What the heck happened to you?
I don't know. You know, it's like when you have a bad experience in one ball game, you get an injury, you can't sit back and, you know, and think a lot about what happened the last game, and you're anxious to get back in the next game and get yourself together by having a good one. And, you know, everybody here, you know, has had a fantastic year. And when I left the ball game, the team did a super job. And, you know, I wasn't there, and I felt like I missed out on part of that game. I felt I had to do everything I could this game to help the team win. And, you know, it's just a team effort.
But, Lynn, you're not only sneaky fast, but you jump out of a dead run faster than anybody I ever saw. You tipped the ball away from Mark Washington, caught on the other side. Have you ever done that before where you played volleyball with yourself?
Well, I've tipped the ball and caught it before, but, you know, last Super Bowl I didn't catch anything. You know, in this Super Bowl, I caught three or four catches, and, hey, you know, I just loved it. Had a great time.
All right, what is that you're holding right there?
This is the game ball for the Super Bowl. It's all mine.
Lynn Swan, you were super today, my friend. Thank you very much. Good luck to you, all right? Sonny, we've got a guy that I think changed the tempo of the game. I said this early in the third period. Lambert, you're still mad. You're still hot. But I saw you doing a lot of jumping and banging, and you knew you had to get it started in the second half. What turned you on?
Well, I felt that in the first half, we were intimidated a little bit, and the Pittsburgh Steelers aren't supposed to be intimidated. We're supposed to be intimidators. So I was a little bit excited, and when after the second field goal, Jarella missed, Harris slapped him around the head a little bit, and that's just not going to happen when I'm out there as far as I look at it, you know. And I think we got going and we picked it up and we did what we had to do to win.
All right. Now, on the first touchdown pass that Drew Pearson sort of slipped under on you, did you get fooled by the fake a little bit? I thought you might have stayed closer to the line of scrimmage than Jack Lambert usually does. Were you supposed to drop a little deeper?
Well, it was a play-action pass and we were in a man-to-man defense. Actually, I was responsible for a back. Jack Hamm and I had two backs going out strong side. And we had a little mix-up in the coverage, and that was what happened.
All right, Jack, a super job again for a second-year man to turn on a veteran defensive unit. The entire team was incredible, and I know you're still a single man, as they say, a bachelor, and good luck to you in your quest.
Thank you very much.
All right, Jack Lambert.
Tom, we have to go to Garrett Bindon in the Dallas dressing room, and then we'll be back to talk with Ernie Holmes.
Okay, Coach Tom Landry, a courageous football team, the Dallas Cowboys.
Well, we're very disappointed. I thought that we had a good chance to win it in the second half. We had things pretty much under control, and I think the block punt really changed the whole momentum. It swung 5 points right there, and that seemed to be the difference at the end.
Tom, it was a game of big plays.
Well, it really was. There was a number of big plays were being made. We made, you know, several big plays ourselves. Gave us our first touchdown on a play, and we couldn't move the ball too well against their defense, but nobody's been moving it very well. But I still felt like our defense was playing well and that we had a real good chance to win. But those two quick errors there in a row, and that cost us.
What about the running game? Did you feel like you shut the Steelers down as you might expect?
Well, I thought we did a fairly good job. When it first started, we were a little bit cautious, and Franco got away from us early, but then we started shutting it down, and we had it well under control. And I think the difference in the ball game today was Swan. I mean, Swan made two great plays covered when he was actually covered on the play, and then he made the last one when we had a blitz on and really had Bradshaw dead to rights and missed him. And that was a ball game.
Tom, were you surprised late in the game where the Steelers on 4th and 9 didn't kick the ball? You almost were able to pull it out.
Well, I was a little bit surprised. I don't think, to give up that much field position with no more time than that left, we had a chance, really. Mm-hmm. If we could have hit two or three plays and gotten out of bounds, we didn't get out of bounds in those things. We had no timeout. If we'd have done that, we might have pulled it out right at the end.
Tom, congratulations on a very successful season.
Thank you.
Tom Landry, let's go back now to Tom Brookshire and Sonny Jurgensen in the Steeler dressing room.
Mr. Jurgensen, would you introduce this fellow, please?
I'm back. He's got a different haircut, but he's back, and he's a winner again. What a great game the defense played, Ernie.
Well, thank you. You know, it was a really tough game all the way through the whole entire game. Really, it was coming off the first part of the game. We was trying to rush Starback in the shotgun and get a lot of pressure on him, but he started running draws and, you know, different traps on us to slow us down. It was a fantastic game. I'm so happy I don't even know how to describe it.
Hey, congratulations. A great win. Maybe we'll see you again next year. Tom?
You know something that's important, though? Ernie, you said it. You used to have the gimmicks going. This year, you said Steelers don't need gimmicks. All we want to do is tee it up and hit people. You guys just played football this year, didn't you?
Well, we came out with the idea of, you know, that we were the champion. We know that we were the champion. We played like champion all the way through the season.
That's some kind of a feeling, isn't it?
It's a glorious feeling. You never can express it.
That's what
I'd like to hear,
Ernie.
All right, Ernie.
That's right. Good luck with Franco now.
All right. Actually, Ernie said he's going to go home and relax for 3 or 4 weeks, and they look forward to another big run for another Super Bowl. Franco Harris, you didn't have one of your big 100-yard-plus days, and I bet you're happier than the 19 100-yard rushing days you've had before.
I am very happy. I'm even more excited than last year. Like all week long, people were saying that it's not the same. We seem a little dull and everything, but right now I feel more excited. And I guess that we're standing around here, we're number one 2 times. And, you know, that's just a great feeling.
All right, Franco, you're still eligible, right? Nobody's put a brand on you or anything. Is it easy to do in Pittsburgh? I understand that, you know, you're sort of king of the court there. What's with the...
Very... very casual about my stuff, you know. I mean, like, I enjoy Pittsburgh and I enjoy life and everything, but like right now I'm just enjoying this, you know. Like, it's just really a great feeling being that you're number one again, and all week long everybody was against us, the papers, and everybody picked the Cowboys to beat us and all this kind of stuff, but like, we knew what we had.
You had it too.
You know, like, we just had some championship blood in us, and we went out there, and it was tight, and we just proved it.
All right, Franco Harris, the great running back, as I said, the best big running back maybe in the history of this game. That takes in a little bit of yardage. All right, Franco, let's go to Brent Musburger right now.
All right, Tom Brookshire back here. You can see we are surrounded by Steeler fans, leaving no doubt at all about which team they think is number one in the National Football League. And we'll be back as the Super Bowl continues on CBS.
Hi, you know the city? We want to go to a really nice place.
Oh, a nice place.
This is going to be a great night, boy.
Oh, a cookout.
It looks great.
Yeah,
let's go here.
Not too pushy.
Another place?
Some things you just know are right, like Schlitz. They've been improving the skills of brewing for over a century because they know you judge the quality of their beer every time you open it.
What do you know about this place?
Some things you just know. You just know.
Oh, you just know.
There's just one word for beer,
and you know it.
One night, that's $21.50.
$21.50? But your sign says $9.99.
Oh, yes, but that doesn't include the pool, your kid, the TV, towels. Surprise!
You get enough surprises when you travel. That's why Holiday Inn thinks the best surprise is no surprise. You'll get a big, comfortable room at a price you can count on. One of 152 special standards for prices, rooms, restaurants that let you know at every Holiday Inn, the best surprise is no surprise.
There's nothing to cheer about.
Get with it. Take hold.
I've got cough drops.
Hold is better than leading cough drops. Read the label.
Have dextromethorphan.
Real cough medicine. 2 hold work up to 4 hours.
Great game.
Great party.
Hey, I've hardly coughed in 4 hours.
Now that's something to cheer about.
Right.
New hold 4-hour cough suppressant. Better than cough drops.
Coming up in 2 weeks, the first of 4 Women's Tennis Association tournaments to be televised live by CBS, featuring the top stars of the game, such as Chris Evert and Martina Navratilova.
All right, we're going to change the mood for just a short time. Go out to Phoenix and find out from Vince Scully what is happening with the Phoenix Open. Vince Scully, if you can hear me, come in wherever you are.
Well, all the excitement, thrills, and suspense of the Super Bowl has been transferred to Phoenix, and we have a story. First, it was youngster Roger Maltby, last year's Rookie of the Year. He led through three rounds. The first chink in his armor occurred in the 15th hole yesterday when he three-putted while Gilder and Trevino birdied. And then today, young Bob Gilder, 25 years old, out of Corvallis, Oregon, 2 years out of Arizona State, has forged the lead to go 16 under and hold on so far. A tremendous charge by veteran Lee Trevino. Trevino just won back at 15 under through 11 holes. Meanwhile, last year's winner, and we're not talking about the Steelers now, we're talking about Johnny Miller. He had won three straight in Tucson, he had won two straight here in Phoenix, and this sums it up. He does not hear the victory march. Instead, it's the bogey blues for Johnny Miller. As you can see, he's 9 under, but 7 back, and just about hopelessly out of the tournament. But can the kid Gilder survive the veteran Trevino? Stay with us. More excitement right here on CBS as we go back to the Super Bowl in Miami.
All right, Ben Scully, thank you very much. We have just received word from the Steeler locker room. Terry Hanratty went over to Chuck Knoll and said if they block the punt, they'll have better field position. So it was Terry Hanratty who dictated the strategy late in the ball game, and the Steelers, of course, did not punt. And right now, a little bit away from the chaos and in a calm position down here at about the 29-yard line is Jack Whitaker. Jack, will you please take it away for a time over there?
Brent, you can never get away from chaos on Super Sunday, but this was a little different. I don't know about you, but I enjoyed that football game. That's the best Super Bowl there has ever been. It all came together today, and it started from the opening kickoff when Dallas tried that reverse and almost went all the way. That signaled everybody here, hey, we're going all out today, and both clubs did. A fast-played game with a minimum of penalties. It included everything of interceptions, block punts, a safety, both teams playing all the way, the burgeoning of that Pittsburgh defense finally to full flower in the fourth period, and the never-give-up character of the Dallas Cowboys. It was the best Super Bowl ever played. Maybe the weather had something to do with it. I don't know. It was good and crisp down here in Miami today, more reminiscent of a New England autumn afternoon than a winter Sunday in January in this subtropic city. And the people helped, the thousands that drove down from the mill towns in Pennsylvania and from the plains of Texas. They understand this kind of weather and that kind of football. 10 years from now, when we look back on the 20 years of the Super Bowl, I think we still may say that Super Bowl III gave it its character, but we'll definitely say that Super Bowl X was when this game came of age. And now back to the chaos and Brent.
Jack, thank you very much. I think more than anybody today who is a sports broadcaster, Jack Whitaker brings a very special brand of perspective. Right now, I want to go back inside the Steeler locker room because I believe that Tom Brookshire is standing by with that marvelous owner of the Steelers, Art Rooney. Tom?
Well, I'll tell you something, Sonny. I can't believe two old jocks like Brookshire and Jurgensen are with the greatest owner in the world. Arthur Rooney, you're getting to be a spoil sport. You keep wanting to win this thing all the time now.
Well, I hope so. It's nice to win. It's a lot easier and nicer to win than it is to lose. And it was a great game for our ball players and our coaches and all of us and our fans and our city.
How about the late Bert Bell, your old friend? Don't you think that maybe Bertram's looking down today saying, my gosh, what kind of a game that Super Bowl is?
No doubt about it. Although he thought that this game would someday grow and be what it is today.
Arthur, anything you wanted to say about Chuck Knoll and the staff? It's not a very large staff. A lot of guys have more people to work with. They have to have done an incredible job.
Well, he's done a tremendous job ever since he's come to Pittsburgh. And I think he's one of the great coaches of all time.
And you know, you're one of the great people of all time. As an owner, I wouldn't know, but as a person, you're something else. You know that, Mr. Rooney?
Well, thank you a lot, Tommy.
Sonny, do you have a question for
me? You know, there's no one more deserving in sports than Art Rooney to win his second. Congratulations. I'm a little surprised that you said you thought there would be more scoring in the football game.
Well, I did. I thought that Dallas would score more than they did, and I thought we would score more than we did, and I was worried about the game ever since Dallas got in it, because they make the big play on the end of the season. Making the big play, you understand that more so than I do.
Mr. Rooney, congratulations again. I'm sure you want to get down and celebrate. And we thank you. You said, get to the players. They're the people that deserve it. Congratulations again.
Who made it, Sonny?
We're going to take his cigar away from him. He can get more where those came from. All right, defensive backs don't get the recognition. I want to give it to you. You are one of a group of assassins. Blaine Edwards, something else, my friend. Tell me about the secondary, and you banged Dallas Cowboys all day, didn't you?
Well, the game, it was a physical game, and we knew going into the game that we had to, you know, try to intimidate their receivers, you know, like Temple was flying all game long. And I think that we done what, you know, we really had to get done was kind of beat them around. And I think at the time that we had to come up with the big plays, we came up with them, like Wagner interception and mine at the ending of the game.
Oh, yeah, just another interception, right? The Super Bowl.
Oh, yeah.
Glenn, were you trying to intimidate them? Because there was action, solo coverage, and even when you guys were under in the zones, there was a lot of banging going off. Why not is the way you guys feel, huh?
Well, that's what we've been trying to do all year long, and last year worked for us. And, you know, like we said, well, why not? It worked last year. Why not do it this year? And I think it works, really works. You know, sometimes you get called for a personal foul, but you got to do it. You really got to do it.
I know what you mean. Glenn, I wanted to show people that everybody in pro football, they weren't all 6'5 and about 255 pounds. You're small, you're tough, and you like to get on with it, okay?
That's right. All right, I think about how big is Texas. It can make up for that size.
All right, Glenn Edwards, then let's go now. We'll be back here with the Super Bowl Steelers locker room in just a moment. Hello, Andy.
Thank you, sir.
I've won an Indy, but I've got to go to work just like everybody else. You may know me for auto racing, but the Yellow Pages has helped make me famous for bikes. My motorcycle dealership out here in the suburbs had an identity problem, like any new business. Yellow Pages helped solve that. Helped put me on the map. If you're in business, the Yellow Pages probably help you too. Who knows? Might even help make you famous.
When it's right, you know it. When it's good, you feel it. When it's clean and it's crisp, like that great taste of Schlitz, you know it.
You know it.
You know it. You know it. There's just one word for beer, Schlitz.
In 2 weeks, the CBS Sports Spectacular will feature the Men's World Cup Skiing Competition from Kitzbühel, Austria, where the leading international skiers will be tuning up for the Olympics.
Phyllis Nerve, I'm sure you agree with me that an athlete who turned in a very special performance in a losing effort was Roger Staubach. Let's go back inside the Dallas Cowboy locker room. Gary Bender has Roger now.
Brett, I couldn't agree with you more. A great competitor, Roger Staubach. And Roger, up to the last play, you were trying to pull another one out.
Well, we were in position there. It was kind of tough. You know, without any timeouts left, and you never know, though. Drew made the play in Minnesota, and of course, Percy Howard was in there, and Drew, and Percy's a basketball player. I try to hit him with a kind of an alley-oop pass in the core of the end zone. I try to hit Drew in a post down the middle, and they're back there. They were laying back, and it was a tough situation.
This has been a remarkable year for the Cowboys.
Well, it could have really been a remarkable year. Of course, today is a disappointment. We had played a great team. Pittsburgh's a tremendous football team, and we had our chances. I scrambled around a few times and didn't get very much. And we had some plays that could have been key plays for us. But overall, when you look at it, you put it in perspective, and maybe in a couple days anyway, it was a good season. But again, you lose, and it's kind of hard to analyze it right now.
Roger, as far as Pittsburgh is concerned, they talk about that forward wall. You were running around back there. How do they compare with some you played this year?
Well, I think overall defensively, there's some great defenses in football, but I think Pittsburgh is, I'd put them up as the best defense. There's teams that are very close to them, and they do certain things better than other teams. But I think my protection today overall was pretty good. A couple times they took away. They were in man when we anticipated zone, and they mixed up their defenses pretty well. And they were in zone a couple times, won the interception of Golden when we anticipated man. So I end up scrambling, but the offensive line, other than maybe on a couple occasions, gave me real good protection. They did a good job against their front four.
Well, they say the Cowboys may even be a year or two away from their best team.
Well, we've got a great football team. The attitude's good, and I know personally I'm anxious to start working out as soon as possible, getting ready for next year. It's hard to, again, analyze right now, but we do have a good team, and you got to work at it, and you can't sit around talking about it, and we're capable of playing better football, and we're looking for a bright future.
Roger, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Roger Staubach. Let's now go back to Brent Musburger.
All right, Gary, thank you very much. We have some highlights, and we'll start off with Roger Staubach in possession of the ball, and you will see him throw that touchdown pass to Drew Pearson that, of course, got the Cowboys out ahead. Irv, here's the first play.
Look at the Cowboys really had things well under control here, hitting Pearson coming across and makes it really a nice catch and run here. Cowboys taking the lead early, 7-0.
Now the Pittsburgh Steeler touchdown. Randy Grossman so wide open. A defensive coverage mistake strikes him for the touchdown. And now the field goal by Tony Fritsch.
Doesn't look like much here, but on this kick, Dallas took a 10-7 lead and felt pretty smug at this point in the game.
Chuck Knoll said the turning point might have been the blocked punt. Tom Landry agreed over in the other locker room. You can watch it now. Reggie Harrison, a special teams player, busting down the middle. And at the time, it looked like a break for Dallas because it went out of the end zone and was a safety. Pittsburgh ball on the Dallas 28. Bradshaw keeps it this time and gets down to the 19-yard line. And from there, Roy Girello.
Girello does the rest, a 26-yard field goal, and Pittsburgh took a lead for the first time, 12-10.
Now, that Steeler defense that was so outstanding from the second quarter on, Mike Wagner steps up, intercepts this pass by Staubach. Gets down to the 5-yard line. This setup still another Girella field goal. It was 15-10 Steelers. And how about the day that Lynn Swan had? This catch for a touchdown made it 21-10 as he sets a Super Bowl record for receptions. But still, Irv, the Cowboys wouldn't quit.
They still had a shot at it. And here, Roger Staubach goes to the corner to Percy Howard, who makes a catch after knocking off Blount here on the corner. Touchdown, and the Cowboys looked like they were coming back, trailing 21-17.
Well, Phyllis, your Dallas Cowboys didn't make it, but I'll tell you, the Steelers are some kind of football team.
I think you know the story today, but I am so proud of my Dallas team, and as Roger said, in a couple of days, they'll put it in the right perspective.
All right. And Super Sunday on CBS continues in a moment.
Here's your car battery. Add water. Keep it clean. It lasts an average of 38 months. Here's the revolutionary JCPenney battery that will make yours obsolete. You never have to add water. And it's so powerful that it's fully warranted for as long as you own your car. If it fails, return it. We'll replace it free. Only at JCPenney auto centers or catalog desks. It's the last battery your car will ever need.
I know, you're not getting a terrific shave from your electric razor. Maybe there's nothing wrong with your razor. Maybe there's something wrong with your face. Your beard is just laying there. Make it stand up with this, Williams Electric Shave. Look, every leading razor manufacturer tells you, use a pre-shave. Most people use Electric Shave. It gets your beard to stand up, so your razor shaves closer and with less irritation. Williams Electric Shave makes your beard stand up, makes your razor shave better.
Two former chorus girls in a one-of-a-kind special. Shirley MacLaine and special guest star Lucille Ball kick up their heels. Be there for Shirley MacLaine, Gypsy in My Soul.
Tuesday night at 10, 9 Central Time, right here.
This brings to a close certainly the most pleasant football season I have ever enjoyed. And Phyllis George, I want to tell everyone that you did a magnificent job this year. And I wasn't too sure about working with a woman, folks, in coverage of football. She did a job. She's Rookie of the Year.
Thank you, Brett. Thank you very much. You know, I've had a ball. I really have. You two have been the greatest. And I've said it before, folks. They are super, and they have cooperated with me, and I hope vice versa through this long football season. And it's kind of sad that it's coming to an end now, but hopefully we'll be back next year.
Yes, it is. And Irv, it was nice to have somebody who understood the game as well as you did around. Well, help us out.
Thanks a lot, Brent. But I'll tell you, you know, it was a team effort. The people in front of the cameras, of course, you see, but we had hundreds of people working behind us who did a whale of a job
like
for us.
Like Mike Pearl.
Quite a day. I just loved it. It was a lot of fun, and I enjoyed it. I hope we are back next year.
All right. Well, you know, the reason why we're all successful, of course, is not us. It's the football players. That's always the story. And I really think we should close out this day with a very special tribute to the Pittsburgh Steelers. We started out with a tribute to all the teams that have made the Super Bowl. Now let's turn our attention to the team that has won back-to-back Super Bowls. And if you listen to these fans, they think they're going to be back next year. So let's take a look at that tribute now.
Company president who was beaten because his workers refused to join a union. A look at the New York City bomb squad and more on 60 Minutes tonight on CBS.